Jonathan, someone said that's good.
Hey, Ryan?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, excellent. So do you hear me well?
Yes, I can hear you very well. Yep.
Oh, that's perfect then. Can you switch the image how it is on our end? Hey, Ryan?
Yes, go ahead.
Can you change the image so that we see how it looks? Okay, excellent. All right, so I think we're all set now.
Okay, so first of all, I want to apologize for not being there in person, but Mother Nature really doesn't like us. We've had 3 storms in 5 days. The last storm dropped over 100 centimeters of snow on us in 24 hours. So just a little insane here, I guess you'd say. I've got Rachel in here too. She's our sales lady. You guys have probably, some of you may have talked to her already. She's going to start out with the general products overview, and I will be here, you know, with technical questions and stuff as well. And in the second half after break, I'm going to talk about charge controllers. Got a little teaser up on the screen for you guys for new products. We'll talk about that at the end of Rachel's presentation right before break. We'll talk about a bunch of new products that Midnight has coming to market really, really soon. So I'm going to introduce Rachel, let her introduce herself while I hand her over the screen so she can start.
Ryan, can you give me just 1 second, please?
Yep.
I am bringing up, I had a problem with the file when I tried to open it, that's all. There we go. All right. And what view should I have this on?
I'm not sure. I know.
You have it up on your screen, or are you showing my screen?
No, I just got the charge controller one up on my screen.
Oh, okay. You don't know what I should show it through on PowerPoint, because I'm not familiar with using PowerPoint.
Just go to slideshow and go from beginning.
Slideshow, view, and go from beginning?
Yep. But I've got to make you the presenter first.
Well, you can take a moment, because I'm still finding go from beginning. So I have it under view.
No, go to slideshow.
Go to slideshow from beginning. Because I don't want it to take up both screens.
Or I can do it here, and you can just talk to the slides, and I'll change them as you want.
Well, we may have to do it that way because I want to see my notes. Which slide are you seeing? Which screen are you seeing?
Well, they're seeing my screen because I haven't made you the presenter yet.
Good, because I want to try and... I want this just to be on one screen. Well, we may have to go with your screen, so... It's not working how I want it to work, but that's okay.
From our part, it's very nice out here.
Yeah, I'll run the slides here and she can talk to it. Basically, the general product overview, our goal with this webinar, and this is a brand new PowerPoint our marketing guy put together, but generally our goal is to get your eyes on each category on our website in the order they're in our website, just to kind of give you a little familiarity with how much stuff Midnight offers, because a lot of people don't really know all the offerings we have, so.
Yeah, we have 35 different product categories, and so obviously you're not going to get to see everything that's in every product category, and like Ryan said, we want to give you a good idea of what we've got. In the accessories section, it's got all the little parts and pieces that you need as far as, you know, the dead fronts for the for our combiners. It gives you the charge controller brackets, the relays, resistors, strain reliefs. It's got all those little parts and pieces. And something that we probably ought to mention too is that when you go and you look at a product on our website, when you scroll down, when you actually click on the product and you're looking directly at the product and you scroll down, we give a list of accessories that work with those products. So you may know that it's something that goes with one of our combiners, but you're not exactly certain what you're looking for. I would suggest you go and you look at that combiner, and then you scroll down and look at the accessories that go with it. And lots of times you'll be able to find pretty much what you're looking for. You can go to the next.
Before you continue, that we've got around 20 persons here that are bilingual. They speak in French and in English. But maybe they will have a few questions for technical question that we'll have to figure a way to do the translation. So
sure. Just stop us anytime you have questions on your end, and we'll work through that. Yep.
Yeah. So I will let you continue. If there's any sign in the place here that someone want to ask a question, I will just stop you and let's see what kind of question they're having.
Sure.
Thank you.
Yep. And I'm sorry, I didn't really introduce myself. I just kind of launched right into it. But I'm Rachel. I work in the sales department, and I work with Ryan. Lots of times when people call and they have questions, they end up talking to me. So please feel free to reach out anytime you guys have questions, email, call. I am pretty much always here.
Okay. Thank you very much, Rachel. And me, I'm Sylvain Loisel from Renatech Energy. I got some people in the place here that are just asking to, when you're speaking, just speak a little bit slower, please. I would appreciate it. Thank you very much.
In our battery accessories section, we have all of our pre-assembled battery cables, as well as our battery status, our battery capacity meter, rather, hydrometers. We also feature the 1,000-amp battery combiners. And those 1,000-amp battery combiners are made of powder-coated steel. They can hold up to 12 of the MNEDC battery breakers. Also, a good thing to note is that the battery cables are available in an assortment of lengths as well as gauges, so definitely take a look at that. Ryan, can you move to the next slide, please? Our battery enclosures, we have indoor enclosures and outdoor enclosures. The outdoor enclosures are not officially listed to 3R, but they are built to a 3R standard. And something to definitely note, I keep referring back to the website, but it's an excellent resource. And if you look at the battery enclosure brochure, which we do have posted on the website, on page 2 of that, we do go through and give dimensions on all of our battery enclosures. Oh, are you going to the website?
Yeah, I'll pull it up while you're talking about that.
Okay, cool. And lots of times when people call me, they ask, well, can my battery fit in this particular enclosure? And I love to point them in the direction of this particular document because it's my go-to. Anytime anybody has any questions about our battery enclosures, I always take them to this document. I take them to page 2 and say, here, we can actually look and figure it out.
Unfortunately, it's in inches, but it does give you a way to look at the battery boxes and figure out what common batteries fit in what boxes. And if you scroll down, it will give you the actual dimensions inside between the shelves, et cetera.
Yeah. So that's sort of a nice hint or tip as far as the battery enclosures are concerned. The indoor enclosures are gray powder-coated steel. The outdoor enclosures are white powder-coated aluminum. Like I said, we do have extra or replacement keys available, as well as extra shelving. Moving on to our breakers. All of the midnight circuit breakers can be used at 100% the rated current when they're mounted in one of our midnight enclosures. And they come in AC and DC. We have DIN rail and panel mount versions. Wide variety as far as 1 amp to 250 amps. We have the ground fault. We also have remote trip breakers for the rapid shutdown equipment. And then, of course, the breaker protectors and then the breaker adapter that would allow you to use 3/4-inch breaker in a 1-inch slot because the 3/4-inch breakers are a little bit more available than the 1-inch ones are. Moving along, we have a bunch of bus bars, insulated bus bars, the grounding bus bars. We also have the 1,000-amp bus bars. Any of the bus bars that you'd be looking for to, like, replace from our combiner boxes, those are also available right here as well. And then moving on. There you go.
So we'll talk about charge controls after the break, but I would still hit on the just real quickly on all three of them here.
Yep. So we have three main charge controllers. The first is the BRAT. It's a 20 amp with a 10 amp load circuit, or you can parallel the two for a 30 amp charge controller. It's a PWM, able to do 12 and 24 volt battery banks. It is a sealed 3R enclosure, so it is weatherproof. Lots of times people like to take this charge controller along with our MNPB3 and use that as a breaker box, and it's also a 3R enclosure. So they'll take both of those and put those together somewhere outside so that this can really be like a truly weatherproof sort of unit for a small DC system of some sort. Does have a 10-amp load circuit with the customizable lighting controller, and I know that Ryan will probably hit more on the stuff, you know, all its special features a little later on in the program. Moving on to the KID, we actually picture it with the brand new wall-mounted unit. It actually comes installed in that wall-mounted unit, and it makes wiring up the kit a whole lot easier. You can actually take off that bottom section, and all of your wiring can be done from the front now instead of having to go into the kit at the back. It makes things a whole lot easier. Having had the experience of having to change out a kit with using that wall-mount unit, it certainly makes changing out kits a whole lot easier. The kit is a 30-amp MPPT charge controller. It will work with 12-volt to 48-volt battery banks. It does have a 2-year warranty. We have a standard and marine version. The standard version, of course, comes with our new wall mount unit. The marine comes with the marine mounting bracket, as you see there on the bottom of the page. The big difference between the two is that the marine kit comes with a few more parts and pieces. There's some conduit. There's a battery temperature sensor, but essentially you're getting the same charge controller with either one. The kit also has a fully programmable load circuit. You got ahead of me.
Sorry.
You know what? We'll just move on to the classics and okay. You want to stay there?
No, that's okay.
Okay, cool. Nope, the only other thing to mention about the KID, I had mentioned that it has the fully programmable load circuit, also has a lighting controller, and it also features AGS, the auto gen start, which is a really nice feature for people who are looking to be able to run a generator and not have to be there to monitor it. But Ryan can elaborate on that stuff later. Moving on to the classics. We have our standard classic, which is capable of solar, wind, and hydro in the 150, 200, and 250 volt models. It does come with a 5-year warranty. It can charge on 12 to 72 volt battery banks. Ground fault and arc fault is standard with both of our classics, and the standard classic is internet ready. It will work with both our local app and our My Midnight website. We definitely have more of those a little few slides along. We have discontinued the Classic Light, and for anybody who is familiar with the Classic Light, what we've come up with to replace that is actually the Classic SL. There we go. There's the Classic SL. And it is our solar-only charge controller. It features a much more streamlined menu. It does not have arc fault, and it does not connect to the internet. Both the standard Classic and the Classic SL will work with our WhizBang Junior, and does feature the Hyper-VOC, which is our non-operational safety zone for the Classics when charging in cold weather climates. Moving on to the PV combiners. These are our standard PV combiners. They can be used with fuses or breakers. There's the MNPV 3 through 16, so we have a range of, let's see what else here. And the only thing to really note with these is that you will need the Dash 250 for the Classic 200 and the Classic 250 if you're using these standard combiners. We do have 1,000-volt combiners in this category. They work with fuses only, and you will need fuses and fuse holders. They are not included.
Yeah, to add to that, we make our combiner boxes a little confusing for you guys. So we call it an MNPV6, the second one in from the right, and it'll hold 6 breakers at 150 volts. But if you put fuses in it, it'll only hold 4 fuse holders. So it's really important to look at the description of the combiners, not just trust the model number, if you will.
And of course, if you have any questions, we're both around and available to help sort out those sorts of things, because a lot of these combiners don't have just one purpose. They have multiple purposes. And so sometimes it gets a little confusing when you're there on the website looking at it. So please feel free to call us, email us anytime with questions regarding this sort of stuff. We also have a couple different specialty combiners. I know that our slide mentions the Tesla Powerwall combiner for combining two of the Tesla Powerwall batteries. We also have an Aquion combiner that we're coming out with specifically for the Aquion batteries. But there are some other batteries that you could also use with that Aquion combiner, just for simple wiring in parallel. We have a transition box for transitioning from PV wire to standard wire, and that box is rated at 1,000 volts. And then lastly, we do have an MNPV6 GFP16 35DC, and that's basically a combiner box that's designed to work for loads that run directly off of the PV array, pool pumps, water pumping, that sort of thing.
Air conditioning, so, yeah.
Yep, there's a lot of different options. Moving on to our disconnecting combiners. Our disconnecting combiners are rated for 600 volts, not 1,000 volts. Some are birdhouse compatible, some are not. We've tried very hard on the website to have the ones that are not labeled very clearly that they are not birdhouse compatible. 4 through 16 string disconnecting combiners. As we mentioned on the slide, the MNPV8HV and the MNPV16HV can be reconfigured in the field to work with the non-isolated inverters. We also have the shutoff boxes, which allow for, basically it's a pass-through, allow you to just shut down rather than combine your strings. And then we also have the dual channel, or the combiners for the dual channel MPBT transformerless inverters so that you could have two negatives and two positives going into one of those inverters. Did you have anything that you wanted to add on that, Ryan?
Yeah, Marco and everybody there, are you seeing anything in the rapid shutdown area yet? Are you being forced to comply with that?
We're not there yet. I know that in other provinces there's a regulation about it, but here it's going to be here soon, so maybe we should take a small look.
Yeah, we can do some separate webinars or something on that in the future, and I'm going to talk about some cool new products to help you guys with that. But something I wanted to point out, just really quickly, hitting on what Rachel commented about some boxes being compatible with the birdhouse and some are not. The birdhouse basically is the initiator for rapid shutdown. The one thing we've done is we've created a whole category on our website for just rapid shutdown products, just because it's such a complicated thing. We tried to put everything under one umbrella so that when somebody does have to go find something, at least they know it has to be in this category or we don't make it. But definitely reach out to me when it comes to rapid shutdown, because it's definitely confusing at best, I guess is the way to say it.
Yeah, it can be a rather complicated category, but...
Yeah, absolutely.
Alrighty. Moving into the e-panels, when you're looking at the e-panels, and we have a lot of different e-panels for all the major inverter manufacturers, Outback, Schneider, Magnum, SMA, Samlex, when you're looking at them on the website, we do have noted at the very top of the page anything special that you might need to know about picking out the proper e-panel. Again, this is the sort of thing, if you have questions, please feel free to give us a ring. Definitely here to help go through that sort of stuff. We do call out all the features on each of the e-panels, and you can see specific products that we make. You know, if we've included it, it is there on the website to take a look at. All manuals, spec sheets, and stuff are there as well. Moving on to the mini DC disconnects. Nope. I'm sorry. Fuses. We do have fuses and fuse holders. We do have a few 600-volt fuses that are still available, but for the most part, we've moved to doing 1,000-volt fuses. And then, of course, our fuse holders are good for 1,000 volts as well.
Yeah, basically what we found was that the cost of a 1,000-volt fuse was the same as a 600-volt fuse. So rather than stocking 600 and 1,000, we've just transitioned to all 1,000-volt fuses and fuse holders. Not a lot more you can say about fuses, but...
Nope. And then our pre-wired systems, AC couple, grid tie with battery backup, the off-grid systems... And again, same brands that we have the e-panels for, we have pre-wired systems for. Was there anything that you wanted to say regarding this, Ryan?
Not really to speak of, but just know that we can, you know, Marco and his team can get you anything you need in the pre-wired department. We're very flexible in what we do. We do everything from just, like, uninterrupted power supplies. If somebody's got a small refrigerator, a few things they want to keep running during a power outage, we can do a small system for that, all the way to full-blown large off-grid systems or grid tie, AC coupled. You know, we have a whole variety of different things there. So if there's a need for anything battery-based with an inverter, you know, reach out to Marco and his team, and they can work with us, and we'll get you exactly what you need. And you're always free to call us as well, you know, with questions if you can't get Marco. But yep.
Alrighty. Now I believe we're moving on to the mini DC disconnects. There we go. Standard, they come with your choice of 125, 175, or 250 amp breakers. They come on the right side, you can get them with those big breakers on the left side as well. They accommodate 5 DIN rail breakers or 3 panel mount breakers. Something that I do like is that we have a plus version of this, which actually gives you 2 spots for breakers so that you can have twice as many DIN rail or panel mount breakers, or you can have 1 of each. It definitely allows a little bit more flexibility as far as the design of your system is concerned. We also have a DCC box, which is pretty much an empty box, and it has an adapter for a 3/4-inch MNEDC breaker instead of one of the big battery breakers. And then we have the MNDC-15, which holds 15 of our panel mount breakers along the center, and it has one of the big battery breakers at the end. And again, you get your choice of 125 amp, 175 amp, or 255 amp. And then the other thing that we do have pictured is the 175 or 250 X2 model that comes with 2 of the battery breakers. So that comes in a slightly larger chassis than our standard mini DC disconnects, but it is available. And moving into the rapid shutdown stuff, Ryan kind of touched on this already in that, you know, basically we have all of this stuff in one spot on the website.
Just basically in a nutshell, a place to go get everything. The system we currently have is basically an initiator box, which goes on the side of the building with the red push button. And it is a system of battery disconnect modules and combiner boxes that interface to this with a standard Cat5 cable. Makes it pretty easy to install. We do have a new system coming out. I don't know why the slides are changing on me, but anyways. We have a new system coming out that will be much simpler. I'll talk about that in a few more slides here. But just know that we get your back with anything rapid shutdown related when it does come up. And as you start seeing it, Marco and Sylvain can put together a quick webinar. We'd be happy to host a webinar, and we can get you guys in here and talk about what we can do and what we can do to help you.
Okay, moving into the small breaker boxes. Pictured there is our big baby box, but we also have a regular baby box, which is a little bit smaller than that big baby box, and then we have an MNEDC quad box. The baby and the big baby box can each accommodate 4 of the DIN rail mount breakers. The quad box can hold 4 panel mount breakers. These boxes will work with the AC or the DC breakers. There's not a lot of wiring room in these things, but they're great for RVs, small off-grid applications. These are not outdoor rated boxes, so these will have to be inside somewhere. Moving on to our software. This is the...
I do want to point out, for those of you who run into it, the baby box is not listed for use. You know, it's just an unlisted box. The big baby and the quad box both carry the proper listings for, you know, if you have to have an inspected system. So just keep that in mind.
Okay. And Ryan will go over some of the software a little bit more in depth when he does the charge controller webinar. But MyMidnight is our cloud-based monitoring solution. It allows you to, from anywhere that you can access the web and look at a website, you can see what your Classic is doing by way of production. There are a number of different parameters, as Ryan will show you here in a minute.
Yeah, so basically, because we're going to run a little quick here on this session, I'll go over a little bit now. The charge controller session tends to be a little longer, so we won't have to go into it. But like Rachel mentioned, there's a bunch of different parameters here you can look at. And if you really get down and deep into the nerdy aspect of it, I actually have a Classic running my radiant heat in my shop, if it'll actually load. And what you're looking at here, the pink lines represent water temperature going in the floor, and the yellow line represents concrete temperature in the slab. And the classic basically turns off and on the boiler every time it's needed to keep the shop warm. So it's just pretty cool what you can do with it, what you can look at. You can stretch it way out, look at a big picture, or you can zoom way in on something. This is really useful if you get into a system where your customer is complaining that, oh, you installed this battery-based system for me. It worked great for 2 years, and now the battery's going dead all the time. You can go back in here and look at things and see what they've actually done. You can look at the battery voltage and kind of get an idea of, are they actually getting some good charging, or did they turn a bunch of extra loads on when you left? Because I don't know how many of you are familiar with doing off-grid systems, but from my past experience, anytime we install a battery-based system for a customer off-grid and we design it properly, the battery is going to go into float every day. The customer is really happy. And then they start to see the batteries in float, and they go buy some more stuff, and they plug more things in. And before you know it, the batteries aren't getting full. And you get into a day that looks like this one here where you don't actually get a full charge. And, you know, the batteries start to slowly degrade in voltage, and they don't hold overnight, and the customer gets, you know, a little antsy and calls you. And this just is a good tool for you because you can look at that and say, oh, well, gee, I wonder what happened here. Maybe they got a bunch of snow and you didn't have any input. But it gives you that tool to go back, and you can go back a year in time and look at each individual day and see what's going on. And like I say, you can really zoom right in on it, you know, get right down to the real granular data here if you want. You'll notice on the left-hand side over here, it's populating as I move my cursor across the time, shows what's going on. So this is just a free service we offer for the classic charge controller, and we will be offering this for all new products, which I'll talk about in a little bit here. So.
And then did you want to bring up the local app and show them that as well?
Sure. Same thing, just different. The local app is a piece of software that runs on your computer. The big difference between the local app and My Midnight is the local app is a direct connection to the classic. Therefore, you know, you can do all the configuration of it. You can set all the auxiliaries and anything you can do from the face of the classic, you can program right here on the local app, which makes it really nice because if any of you have played with the classic or an Outback or a Morningstar, really any charge controller, you'll know that because space is limited, us manufacturers have to give you just a couple buttons and a small display. And it can get a little tough to, you know, actually go through that and see what's going on. But here we've broken it down into basic, advanced, and technical menus so that, you know, you, in theory, if you're setting up a solar array, you probably don't have to go to the advanced or tech. If you just want it to be a solar controller, you're going to go into the basic settings here. You're going to program your absorb, your equalize, your float voltage, simple things like that. But if you really want to get down in the weeds, you can go over into the tech menu and, you know, you go down here and set all your features like ground fault and arc fault, etc. It's just kind of a neat thing. The other cool thing about it is it data logs to the actual PC every 2 seconds. So if you're trying to find a problem or an oddity with the system, you could actually throw a laptop computer in there, run this, and it will log every 2 seconds, and you can export it as a Excel spreadsheet and go back and look at that data and really, really dig into that and figure out what's going on. Is the wind turbine doing this, or is the hydro turbine doing that? You know, it just gives you another tool in your toolbox, but pretty easy to use software. Like I said, no cost. Install it on the computer and it auto detects the classics on your network. You can use this remotely, but you do have to port forward in your router. So I will leave it at that.
Brian, we got a question here for software.
Sure, sure.
How do you connect to the controller? Is it wired or is it Bluetooth or is it Wi-Fi or?
Yep, so the classic itself has an Ethernet jack on it, so it would get connected to an Ethernet cable to the router somehow. You could use a wireless bridge back to a wireless router. You could use just a Cat5 cable back to the router, but it physically needs a wired connection to something that connects to the router.
Okay, perfect, and it works with Mac, I guess, too?
Honestly, I'd have to look into that, but I believe it works with Mac. I know it works with Linux, so I would assume it works with Mac.
Well, it it says it works with Mac. Yeah, no, I tried it. It didn't work, but that's okay.
Yeah, I'll have to look into that. I honestly, I'm drawing a blank on that one. I do know that it works on Linux. I've got it personally running on Linux myself. But Mac, I can't swear to it one way or the other. I'd have, you can definitely email me. Marco or Sylvain can get you my contact info, and I can look into that on the back end for you.
Okay, thank
you. Did you hear, well, the question you folks up there? Because it was pretty far, so I just want to know if you heard where.
Yeah, I heard him just fine. I was a little quieter than you are, but it was very easy to understand. Yep.
Oh, yes. Yep. And moving on to our surge protection devices. Definitely they come in 115 volt, 300 volt, and 600 volt. The 300 volt is available in AC and DC. Varieties. They all work with either, you know, AC or DC, so it definitely some flexibility there. We have two blue LEDs on either side of the SPDs, which will help you see if they're actually working. If you should notice that one or both of those LEDs are out, usually that means that there is something wrong with the SPD. So you like to take a look at that. Our SPDs are fully repairable. They have a 5-year warranty, and they are covered under warranty even if hit by lightning because they are doing their job. So that is something you can definitely have looked at. We also get a lot of people who ask us if you can use our SPDs for three-phase systems, and you can. We do have a wiring diagram, and that's something that I would suggest that you call and you talk to Ryan about. You'd be using the SPD-600s, and we can definitely get you the wiring diagram or point you in the direction of it. It is something that we have on the website. And do you have anything to add to that, Ryan? Or
not a whole lot. The only tidbit I will add to that is if you're doing a DC system and you're using an MPPT charge controller, typically – you know, if you're using, say, a Morningstar or an Outback or a Midnight or a Magnum, they've got voltage ratings. You know, like an Outback is 150. Magnum is 200 volts. So I'll pick on the Outback one for a minute because they limit to 150. Let's say you're going to do two 60-cell modules in series. You're looking at maybe 80, 90 volts, 9,500 volts open circuit up there in your cold climate in the dead of winter. So it may be tempting to use the 115, thinking that you're going to clamp earlier and maybe save more electronics if there is some lightning. But generally speaking, electronics can handle several thousand volts for a few milliseconds. So that's not a big concern. The concern I have with using the 115, say, on that Outback, is if you happen to go back a couple years later and want to add some modules, it may be tempting to say, oh, gee, you know, I'm going to add one more module per string, so I don't have to rewire the combiner box. I just series one more module, and now you've exceeded the 115 volts, and the SPD is going to start to conduct, and then it's going to short out and do its job because the voltage is a little above what it's supposed to be. So I always base my SPD on the charge controller voltage. So if you're going to do a Morningstar 600-volt controller, use an SPD-600 no matter what the array voltage is. If you're going to do a classic 250, use an SPD-300. If you're going to use a classic 150, do an SPD-300. If you're doing a Magnum, do an SPD-300. So I always tend to do that just because I've seen a couple installers get into problems with that, not even problems they created themselves. They actually went in to modify a system that somebody else had installed and said, gee, there's six strings of PV here. There's two in each string. I'm just going to add six modules and make it three in each string. And then next thing you know, this thing is conducting and they've got no voltage at the charge controller and they can't figure out why. And we find out somebody used a 115. So that's just a general rule of thumb that I like to throw out there just to kind of save you from getting into any mischief.
And then do you want to take over from the transfer switches, because this is pretty much getting into the wind and hydro stuff?
Sure. So I'll pick up here. We've got a few more products to talk about, and then I want to go into new products. And Marco, we're going to try to go until like about 2:30 before break. Is that right?
Yeah, no problem.
Okay.
Marco left. He had another appointment, but I will be there to answer and take a look with the question that we got.
Okay. Yeah, and again, don't, you know, feel free to stop me at any time with questions. They don't have to wait until the end. So transfer switches and stop switches, they're basically built around the same architecture. The stop switch is used for a wind turbine. Transfer switch is used for, two different AC sources. So if you've got an inverter, like a Magnum inverter, let's say, that has a single AC input, and maybe you want to have a generator as backup to the grid, you need a way to connect both to that inverter. This transfer switch is basically a very simple way of doing that. It lets you select between, like, the generator or the utility to go into that Magnum inverter. Or you could do it the opposite way. If you had a particular load that you wanted to be able to move from the grid to the inverter during certain conditions, you could use this same transfer switch to do that. It's available in a 30-amp version and a 60-amp version. Both versions are 120, 240. You could use them for 120 only if you wanted to. But as shipped, they do come with the two-pole breakers, so they would work as 120, 240. And wind and hydro. I don't know if you guys, does anybody in the room do much in the wind field?
No.
Okay, so I won't go too far down the road. Just know that we have equipment that can control DC wind turbines or DC hydro turbines. So if you get called on to repair a system that has a wind turbine or a hydro turbine, or install something, just give us a shout, reach out to us. We have clippers that can control those so they don't run away or overvoltage things, and we have MPPT controllers that can properly charge batteries for them. So I don't want to drag you down a long road on that if nobody does wind. So I'm kind of at the end of the general overview, and I'm going to go into some new products. But before I go into the new products, I will stop. And is there any questions? Did I miss anything somebody wants to talk about, et cetera?
I think it's very clear and no question.
Okay, perfect. So moving forward, we're really excited about what you see on your screen now. This is our new power system. This is not an inverter. It's a power system. This is your breakers, all your breakers to do the installation correctly. It's all the metering. It's your charge controller modules and your inverter modules all in one chassis. This will come in a 3-position chassis or a 5-position chassis. What you see here is 5 positions. And what that means basically is you have these hot swappable modules that can be put in. You may only have one, you may have all 5. But this allows you to build a very flexible power system, you know, for a battery-based system, either off-grid, grid-tied, self-consumption, whatever the install may demand. Each one of these modules is about 2,000 watts if it's an inverter module. The charge controller modules, we have a 200-volt version that does about 8,000 watts. And we have a 600-volt version that does about 5,000 watts. And again, you can do up to 2 charge controller modules in this inverter and or up to all 5 inverter modules. So the general theory here was to be able to take this box and give you one 200-volt charge controller and 4 inverter modules and replace an Outback Radien and 2 FM80s. In a much smaller package. It's pretty cool. Let me pull this up real quick. Here's just a little bit more on it, you know, a little bit more pictures. This is one of the modules that goes in. You can stack it up to 4 high. You know, just kind of a cool all-around system. And like I say, 2 kilowatt inverter modules, 5,000, 8,000 watt MPPT modules. It is definitely redundant. Hot swappable. How many of you in the room have had to go out and replace manufacturers' electronics when they do break? Okay, good. So, you know, that's not a fun thing to do. You know, it's usually unpaid, or if it is paid, it's undercompensated compared to what you could be doing with new construction. What's cool about this is these modules are hot swappable, and you'll notice there's four thumb screws, one in each corner. When there is a failure, and I say when, because every manufacturer is going to have equipment failures, no matter what they tell you. When there is a failure, the inverter will not go offline. It'll just lose one of its modules. And we can send out a new module. The customer loosens these four thumb screws. This module literally just slides right out of the rack. The door closes so they can't touch anything. They take the new module out of the box, line it up with a couple card guides, slide it in, and it lights right up and goes to work. And then they tighten up the four thumb screws. So now this becomes repairable within 5 or 10 minutes, and you never had to roll a truck or anything to deal with it. So it's going to be a pretty sweet system from that respect. Every component in it is repairable in the field. The control board is right here. The relay board inside, the relays will most likely be socketable. We're really hoping to have this in a very extensive beta program fourth quarter of this year. And then depending on how UL listing goes, we're really hoping to have it, you know, at Rematech for sale quickly in 2018. But as anybody that's ever dealt with UL knows, that is a moving timeline. So we're hoping for a quick run through UL, but you just never know with that. But anyways, that's our new power system that we're coming out with. Any of you that have made it to any of our recent shows have seen this, but it's just kind of a pretty cool product.
We found that totally amazing, and we got a question for you.
Sure. Go ahead with the question.
Do I understand that it's the 600 volt, that's for the charging. Can you use it for solar, but at the same time for hydro or windmill?
Okay, so the 600 volt is, it could be solar, wind, or hydro, but not both at the same time. So you'd end up having to put in a couple modules, one for solar and one for hydro, if you wanted to do that.
Okay, so you would have one module for each different type of energy coming in.
That is correct, yes, yep. Now, that being said, I don't think we've got a slide on it, but we're working on a new charge controller. It's a standalone charge controller that would have to mount on the wall beside this. But it will be a 200-amp dual MPPT charge controller. So one side of it could track a wind turbine, and the other side could track a solar array independently. So it'll be a lot like your grid tie inverters that have dual MPPT. The charge controller will be the same way. It'll have two channels, 100 amps each. You could parallel them for a large solar array or keep them isolated for two different energy sources.
And this will be out next year, so you're giving us a new option in the 600-volt charging.
Exactly. We're in hopes to also make the dual MPPT available in 600 volts, and, of course, this will be available in 600 volts. So we're just trying to open some doors. One of the things that we're trying to do is make a complete system. We've always focused on balance of system and charge controllers and everything else, but we have always been really good at power inverters. We did all the Outback equipment, we did the Trace equipment, and we helped with the Magnum equipment. So it's just something we felt really strongly that we really wanted to do a really cool inverter. These modules are high frequency, so they're very lightweight. This assembly goes on the wall at about 50 pounds, and then the modules themselves weigh about 10 pounds apiece. So, you know, you can hang this rack on the wall at about 50 pounds by yourself and then populate the modules. So it's kind of something we're trying to break some new ground and give you guys some new options.
And what's your target price if you compare to other brands?
Sure. So on this particular product, being kind of the flagship inverter, what we're trying to do here is we're going to try to target a price that will be less than, say, an Outback Radien of two FM80s. So we want to be competitive to an equivalent size system from Outback or Snyder, if you will.
Right.
And then, of course, we will have a full line of smaller inverters, not modular, but we'll build like a 4-kilowatt inverter that's in a chassis similar to, say, a Magnum or the new Snyder SW. just a lower cost inverter, you know, for those small cabin systems and stuff.
Very interesting. Thank you.
So I won't bore you a lot on this because you guys are not forced of rapid shutdown yet. But by the time you are, just know that we have a very low-cost solution here that's going to do rapid shutdown. Basically, this is the piece on the right is a receiver that goes on every module or one on every string. I got to quit hitting that wheel. One on every string or one on every module, depending on what code cycle. I believe you guys right now are only having to shut down the array, not every module, but states actually just passed 2017 NEC, which requires us to actually shut down every single module on the roof. It's a big burden, actually. You know, it's really forcing installers into microinverters and stuff like that. So we've designed this product to be very low cost, very robust, and it's very simple. This goes on the module. This goes down at the grid tie inverter or charge controller. This injects a power line carrier signal onto the PV wires. This listens for the signal. If the signal's present, it turns on. If it's not, it turns off. Just very low cost. This is actually out now at three of the big players being tested. SolarCity, Vivint, and Sunrun are doing some extensive testing on this. If all goes well, it will be off to listing here within a couple weeks. So really excited about this product, just offering a low-cost, rapid shutdown solution for you guys. Oh, this one is more of a guy's toy. You know, this is something that the guy that just likes to fidget with stuff is going to really love. It's a small grid tie inverter for either wind or solar. Do about 750 volts. No batteries involved anywhere. It has a color display, capacitive touch buttons, and Bluetooth. So you can connect to it with your cell phone app, program it, watch it, etc. Again, it's not intended to replace Enphase inverters or SolarEdge. But it's going to be one of those where if you just want to throw a couple, three modules on the roof and connect something to it, and you really like gadgets, this is going to be really cool. Or if you've got a small wind turbine, 500 or 1,000-watt wind turbine, and you just want to grid tie it, you know, you just want to hook it up and make it do something without actually spending a lot of money on batteries and stuff, this will be a nice low-cost way of doing that. It is a complete aluminum casting, and this should be... I'm guessing if everything goes right, which it looks like it's going to, this should be available sometime by the end of this year. And the Wind Kid and Kid Clipper. Not a lot to say there. Just it's like the classic, other than it's a lot smaller. So if you've got a real small hydro, maybe, you know, 500-watt hydro or something, the classic may not make a lot of sense because of its size. It's just so big. This will be a lower cost solution to get that done instead of having to, you know, go as big as that. Kid, as you know, will do a 12, 24, or 48-volt system. It's good for up to 1,500 watts on a 48-volt system, et cetera, et cetera. I have no idea on availability on this. The holdup on this product right now is that the engineer that did the Kid is actually doing a lot of modifications to the Solar Kid, as well as doing the dual MPPT, as well as doing the charge controller modules for the new inverter system. So he's focusing a lot on the solar aspects right now. So this is kind of taking a little bit of a back burner, but I do expect you'll see this sometime mid-2017. And wind turbines. Not sure how I feel about wind turbines, but some people really like them, some people hate them. But Robin has decided that he really wants to offer a few wind turbines. So we're going to have the old Chinook 200 was built by Pine Ridge Products. They're friends of ours. They decided to quit building that just because they didn't want to be a manufacturer. We have brought that back and made some engineering improvements to it. And we're also building a 500-watt version of that. The 500-watt will work with that grid tie inverter we showed earlier. They'll all be available as battery charging units. The 500-watt version has some smarts to it. It has a clipper built into it. as well as a vibration sensor, etc. And it even comes with Bluetooth, so you can, you know, go over near the tower, connect to it with your cell phone, and download the data from it. The 500 watt will be nice for remote sites when you guys get into some stuff up there where maybe a railroad or something, or a remote telecom site where they just don't get quite enough sun to really make solar work reliably all winter. You know, that might be something that you look into using. The fact that it's got the smarts built into it can help, you know, keep itself from tearing itself apart during an ice storm or whatever. And I think that's pretty much brings me to the bottom of the first presentation. So hopefully you guys got lots of questions before break.
You know, presentation is so cool, and you got all the information. It's very clear. I don't have any question. Maybe one here, okay?
J'ai beaucoup de clients francophones qui ne lisent ni ne comprennent l'anglais. Quand ils font le traduction des systèmes classiques, il faut que je leur traduise les livres au complet ou toutes les questions, ben, documentation en français, un start-up en français.
Okay. There's one of the installer here that has a lot of clients that are French or francophone.
Okay.
He has to translate all the information or the spec sheet to them when they're selling the product. Do you got any other language than English when we got spec sheet or a kind of startup kit that you can have the French version?
Sure, and that's a very good question, and I am happy to work on that. We did get started on that at one point, and we seemed to die off, I think, just because there wasn't a big drive behind us. But as you can see here, we've done the classic and classic light in French. So, yes, I'm happy to work on that. And if you want to email me directly, you know, you can get my contact info from anybody there. And I can start on the documentation that you need first, and we can get that done. And if there's somebody there that wants to help proofread some of these as we do translate them, that would even make it go faster, because that's, quite frankly, I think where we stumbled a little bit was in the proofreading after we, you know, translated them.
Exactly. Okay. It's about the owner manual.
Okay.
About that and the startup, the same thing we have in English.
The startup guide.
Very simple. All the information of the owner have to do at the installation. Not the the complete data, only the startup, and after he plug it and how he can put the information of his system.
Okay, yeah, I got you. Yeah, I can definitely work on all of those. There's no problem with that at all. You know, Rachel can help as well. There's a bunch of us here that can work on that. So I think that the big thing would be just shoot me an email so that it's fresh on my plate. Tell me what you need first, and I will get working on that. I'll get our marketing guy to start working on it on his end, putting the documentation together, and we will get it off to some of you for proofreading.
Thank you. Perfect. Thanks a lot.
We got another question here.
Okay.
Your wind turbine.
Yes.
You have a price on that? You know how much are you on a cell phone?
I don't at the moment. I know that the 200-watt version, the goal was to be competitive with the Primus, small Primus. The 500-watt, I don't know. The 200-watt should be going live on the website within 3 to 4 weeks, I'm told. The 500-watt, we actually just hired a production engineer to oversee that line and get things rolling, that will be probably needing some extensive beta testing. I'm going to say we're going to be looking for a lot of people that are willing to play with them for, I'm hoping, like a year, because I really want to get some time on it before we just start selling it, because that seems to be a common problem in the wind industry, is people will make a new wind turbine and just sell it to you without any real hours on it, and then you guys do the actual testing. So we, on the 500-watt one, we're going to want to do some pretty extensive testing before we actually sell it.
I'm quite surprised to see all the new product that your guys are working on. It's really amazing, and we're really happy to hear that.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's one thing that I have to give Robin credit on, is he's always been the type to not sit still. Sometimes too much so. Sometimes so much that we have so many engineers and so many ideas on our plate that it makes your head hurt thinking about which direction we're going to go today. But it's definitely been great for the industry, because we, you know, we just keep progressing. I mean, for those of you that have been doing battery-based stuff for a while, you know, you can remember way back in the Trace days when you wired up one of those old DR inverters, those square wave inverters, you couldn't even fit two fingers in the wiring compartment, let alone a hand. And each time Robin has moved along, he's given us better breaker boxes, better this, better that. So he does have a pretty good vision for that. So it's kind of exciting to keep moving forward with new products and kind of keep the industry on their toes, if you will, and innovative.
Yeah, we got another question.
About the wind clipper, is it possible to use it with other products, other wind turbine?
Yes, so the wind clipper itself is a standalone device. It will interface with the Classic if you're charging a battery, but it basically is a standalone device with a voltage controller in it that will limit the maximum speed of the wind turbine. The only caveat to that is the clipper has a limit of 250 volts. So if the turbine is going to be like a 600-volt grid-tie turbine, you're not going to want to use it. But if you're doing, you know, a lower voltage turbine into anything else, then the clipper would work just fine.
Thank you. I think that's about it. Is there any other question?
Yeah,
just
a reference. If we want to send you an email, what's your email address?
Ryan, R-Y-A-N, at midnightsolar.com.
Okay.
And I can do this during the break. I can leave the website up with Rachel and I's contact information on it as well, so that you guys can copy it down or whatnot. Yeah. But right down here in the bottom, you'll find our tech support manager, our tech support employees, Rachel's contact, my contact, and Walter wouldn't really apply to most of you, but for Marco and Sylvain, it would. He's the guy that you want to call and holler at when products aren't shipping as fast as you'd like.
Well, we got all that, so thank you very much. We'll take a small break of, 15 minutes? Is it okay? Yeah. Well, what about you guys, Rachel and Ryan? Is it okay for you?
Yeah, 15, so say 20 past, 25 past, 2:30, somewhere in that ballpark. Yep.
Okay.
All right, we will leave the webinar on so you guys have this, and we will keep, we'll be back in a few minutes. Look forward to the second half.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
C'est bien dispendieux, une bête de même.
Ben, ouais, écoute, non, je trouve pas que...
Tu mets ça dans mon truc, ça envoie le grand tabarnak.
Non, écoute, on parle des choses qui fonctionnent, qui ont peur.
C'est ça.
Ce qu'on a comme fournisseur de produits, on n'a pas de cochonnerie.
Ça, c'est
ça. J'adore. C'est vraiment un très bon produit.
Ça, en réalité, c'est un peu la même chose, mais en plus petit. Mm-hmm. Quand même, dans mon temps, tu vas faire le job aussi. Moi, je vais me garder les panneaux à bas, c'est le plat, là.
Oui, oui.
Ça va refaire. Je vais gérer ça.
Mm-hmm. OK.
Merci beaucoup.
OK.
Salut. Hey, à la prochaine. Salut. Bonjour. J'aimerais, moi, en réalité, une bête de même au lieu d'une chose normale. C'est que moi, j'ai l'ordinateur en train. Je pourrais voir vraiment comment que tout se comporte dans mon camion, là, avec, tu sais, selon mes journées, mes consommations, ouais. Selon tout. Ouais. Avec une affaire de même, moi, je vais communiquer avec mon portable.
Ouais, je vais trouver ça.
Ça en vient. Ça fait un peu militaire, tous les machins avec le cadran bleu. Là. Ça fait militaire, ça fait bien long, on va dire. Je pense que tu vas aller chez le gars, mais pas après. C'est vrai. Le gars va se passer en meurtre.
Avec ça, tu vas aller chercher un madame, c'est bien de faire ça.
Avec ouais, ça, écoute-moi, là, m'a dit.
Tu vas confondre les rondelles.
Hey, installe ça, c'est moi, là. C'est ça que tous tes voisins viennent te voir. Qu'est-ce que c'est, le tente? C'est une cage à moineau. Une mangeoire à moineau, c'est le bord du compteur électrique, là. Une petite mangeoire à moineau, c'est le bord du compteur électrique, là. Il y a un bord là-dedans, là.
Ouais, c'est génial.
Oui, communiquer avec le barbe. Le barbe, il est ailleurs. Ça, c'est un camo chou. Ils l'ont aussi. Il est carré. Oui, ils en ont mis deux. Ils sont sûrs qu'on y a le pauvre dedans. Mais si on se fie en dessous, là, il n'y a pas de barbe là-dedans. Non, le barbe, il était ailleurs.
OK, c'est juste un 4-5.
Lui, il communique avec le barbe. Il fallait que tu emmènes un fil de lui au barbe.
Okay,
ah, okay. Okay. Non, non, non. Ça, c'est juste le mushroom dehors. Puis tu pars un fil de lui pour aller donner une info à l'autre.
Ouais, c'est ça. Mais semblait que le
board
est
juste
avec un petit piton blanc, mais...
Ça. Okay. Moi, je suis sûr que le board est ailleurs.
Parce que d'après moi, ça communique avec ton chargeur et tes autres équipements d'automatique shutoff.
Ça donne juste sa langue.
C'est sûr que dans les portiers, quelque chose comme ça.
Oui, parce que le bord, il semblait être normal. Il aurait dû être,
moi, j'aurais simplement mis des manches
dans le bâtiment. Juste des mushrooms avec un petit boîtier jaune dehors. Regardez
ce boîtier-là pareil.
Parce qu'en réalité, il doit donner bien d'informations, le bord. Tu peux être dehors et avoir déjà ton info. C'est vrai de ça. On a même affaire les pompes, là. Celle-là, là. Mon chaud piscine travers, je suis allé au salé, là, il a bossé l'année passée. Il a bossé. J'ai oublié de racheter une scène et le ressouder sur mon bord. Ouais, j'ai fait venir sur eBay, là. Je vais ressouder sur mon barbe.
Ça, c'est hard, c'est pas pratique, c'est facilement rapatable. Ouais. Mais c'est ça que tu veux dire?
J'ai mon kit d'eau salée, là. C'est comme un contrôle. Là. Et quand tu ouvres le panneau, tu as des scènes de même dessus. Là,
Ouais, c'est ça.
Puis il y en a un qui était fendu complètement. Tant qu'il est ouvert carrément. J'ai checké le numéro dessus, je l'ai collé sur eBay, ça a pris 2 jours, ça m'a coûté 2,30 $. Écoute, chez Club Piscine, là, tu peux pas l'avoir. Il faut que tu changes le bord au complet, les autres changent le bord, quand il ne marche plus, ils changent le bord. Ça m'a coûté 2,30 $, je fais venir la chose. J'ai sorti mon fer à souder, j'ai soudé ça dessus, j'ai reparti mon chose, j'ai marché ça à coche. Ouais. Une surcharge électrique en quelque part, puis bang, ça a pété 6 mois.
Ça va bien, là, tu peux l'installer, c'est ça qu'il dit, tu peux pas l'installer juste sur ça, tu peux l'installer sur n'importe quoi. Comme nous autres, on a eu c'est un bâtiment commercial, il y avait beaucoup de clair. L'année passée, cet été.
Ah, mais qu'est-ce qui coupe? Le fil est tout petit. Ça va couper quoi?
La seule chose que ça fait, c'est que ça ramasse le voltage. Ça va ramasser, dans le fond, tout ce qui est plus haut que le voltage normal. Il va créer un chemin de faible impédance vers l'autre. Si jamais il y a de quoi, c'est trop.
Ah, c'est ça qui va péter au lieu que tu sautes d'autres affaires.
Oui, parce qu'ils ont pété pour 10 000 piastres d'éclairage. Fait qu'ils étaient bien contents d'avoir des solutions.
Ça a quand même ses limites.
Ouais, non, mais ça, on les a proposé ça après, tu sais, parce qu'on s'est rendu compte que le bâtiment était mal grondé aussi, fait qu'il a fallu refaire du grondé, ajouter des searches comme ça, des searches square D. C'est fait par minute, tu
vois. Sans réalité, c'est carrément un petit contrôleur, tout simplement.
C'est juste là qu'il ne soit pas un peu pété.
Ouais, c'est ça. Il est moins tentant un peu. Bon, une petite installation de rien. Mais ça, dans mon truck, ça ne serait pas pire faire. C'est ça, dans mon truck, ça ne volerait pas pire. Il faut communiquer avec mon portable en avant, là, puis voir un peu Toutes mes infos.
J'en ai un sur mon bureau. Je me fais un malin plaisir de le laisser sur mon bureau. Ainsi
ça va. Parler de monde.
Puis ça va, il est complètement grillé. Là. Je viens, puis quand tu me proches, ça sent pas bon.
Ça sent encore.
Ça sent encore. Fait que ça a une utilité, c'est pas de pouvoir.
En attendant, ça fait ça à peine. Ça fait ça à peine, moi. Jusqu'à temps que ça t'arrive.
Ça vaut à peine. Quand tu reçois la facture au bout, là, tu t'es parti, ça vaut à peine pas. Je sais pas comment ça coûte, là.
Ça coûte pas cher.
T'sais?
Ça coûte pas cher. Un éclair dans tes équipements, ça coûte cher.
C'est quoi
cette place? Ouais. Moi, je pensais pas qu'il y avait autant de produits que ça.
Mais alors, c'est un 300, celle-là.
Je pensais
pas que c'est un 320. C'est un AC, celle-là, 320.
OK, j'ai pas le temps de les élever. C'est pesant,
hein?
Pas je trouve. Il y en avait deux,
mais
le gars
d'avait. Mais hier?
Ouais, il doit être encore l'autre.
Ah oh mon god, allez, ils sont encore là?
C'est quoi ça?
Mets ça dans mon trait. Sérieux?
Ah,
t'as tiré?
C'est ça.
Ça avec 3-4 panneaux, c'est le top, là, une table business.
Ouais.
Ça va charger en tabarnak dans ce truc-là, tu vois.
Ouais.
Ah, le but, c'est que le monde pose des questions, après qu'ils veulent en avoir. C'est ça le but d'exercice. Si tu mets de la papa, ils ne sont pas impressionnés.
Ah, ça, c'est le top.
Ça, c'est un 30 ampères. Mais mettons, là, moi, c'est bien beau mettre un 30 ampères. Si, mettons, je corde des panneaux, ben, il est peut-être pas assez lourd, on devrait en mettre plus qu'un.
Juste des hausses 200 ampères.
Si, mettons, on veut hausser sur mes panneaux, je ne sais pas, un exemple, il est 60 volts. Ça veut dire que si lui est VOC,
79 ampères.
Ça veut dire que s'il est VOC 200, ça veut dire que je peux mettre 3 panneaux de VOC. Si c'est marqué VOC, mettons 60. Ça veut dire que je peux en mettre 3 en série.
Ah, moi, comme il disait, il y en a d'autres que tu peux mettre d'autres panneaux, tu vas juste clipper ce qu'il n'y a pas besoin.
Connais-tu l'outil de
Size and Tool?
Donc, c'est un très bon outil.
Ah, le site,
hein? Le site. Il va dire, tu le marque de ton
panneau
solaire. Puis, il me semble qu'il n'y a pas besoin de mettre des spécifications.
Oui, mais l'affaire, c'est que tu vas faire un tour à soir, puis il y en a un. Il va commencer à aller amener ses sites.
Le voltage. Mais aussi la température. Plus c'est froid, plus le virus va en partir. Parce que c'est ça le problème au Québec. Le matin, Marco disait qu'il y a beaucoup de récupérateurs qui ont sauté.
À cause de ça, à cause de la température qu'on a ici.
Et c'est bien dispendieux.
850. Bon, excuse, ça c'est mon fils.
Ça, c'est un bon de le faire, ça, pour
nous. Mais lui, il est un trailer.
Mais je vais garder deux, trois panneaux pour 300
watts. Ça,
ça sera pas assez gros. Ah non, ça me prend quelque chose de plus fort. Oui, parce que si le VOC, je ne sais pas, moi, il est à 150, je ne peux pas encorder 3 sur le doigt.
Oui, mais ça, tu peux pas calculer en fonction de limiter ton VOC, de cette température qu'on a ici en région.
Donc, comment tu dis, c'est le VOC qui marque, c'est...
Non, mais ça, c'est le facteur, que c'est la multiplication que tu vas mettre, il faut que tu vas être bon pour de ton calcul.
Tu mets 1.25?
Ben, je avec l'outil de dimensionnement, c'est parfait.
Moi, mon outil de dimensionnement, c'est marqué.
Ah, là, tu peux le mettre le facteur de température.
Eux,
moi, j'appelle Marco, regarde, c'est ça, je
vois. C'est ça, je t'organise.
Moi j'ai ça. C'est quoi que ça me prend qui va marcher avec ça? C'est quoi ton prix?
La pile là.
Combien de panneaux, tellement de planètes, faut que tu respectes ça.
Mais là, c'est pour ça qu'il faut que j'aille voir qu'est-ce qu'il y a avant. Mais tu dis qu'il y en avait une
couple. Je pense qu'il y en avait un 24 heures. Il y en avait 24 heures 60. Il était juste à côté.
Parce que tu vas chercher ton bocal. Il y a des places qui recommandent de prendre cette ça.
Pourquoi?
SolarEdge dans certaines de mes applications, puis dans certains états où ce que tu es, t'as pas le droit d'installer ça.
Ça?
Ouais. Quand on regarde, mettons, ouais, vraiment sur les installations de SolarEdge par rapport à les onduleurs, parce que eux autres, le Lightning Air Restore est intégré.
Ah, ok, ok.
Ah, ok, merci, il y en a déjà un.
Il
ne
faut pas doubler.
Ouais. Bon, Marc, c'est ça. Il est intégré à l'Inverter. C'est pour ça qu'ils disent que dans certaines magnétiques, dépendant de l'équipement, puisque tu l'as acheté pour les codes nationaux, tu peux ou ne pas l'acheter.
Je vais, bon, il n'y a pas de code.
Il n'y a pas de problème avec ça.
Il n'y a pas de problème là-dessus. C'est sans bien. Il y a
Non, c'est pas bon. c'est
ça me fait toujours peur de voir ça. Mais ça, c'est le bord d'une maison, des enfants qui passent et s'amusent à les peser dessus.
Il doit avoir moyen de bloquer ça.
Il ne faut pas le bloquer parce que les pompiers veulent avoir accès. C'est le lèvre. Moi, je vois toujours les enfants m'incommodent comme j'étais. Là. On a fait sauter des enfants, on va faire la raison. Donc. Les gars, il est 2h30. On va s'installer tranquillement, s'il vous plaît.
Just want to take a look, Ryan and Rachel, are you there?
I'm here.
Okay, thank you. People are starting to sit down and we're ready to rock and roll.
Ryan, are you there?
Yeah, sorry about that, guys. I was on the phone with engineering. I was trying to get rid of them. I am ready whenever everybody else is.
Good. Ready?
All right. Well, hopefully everybody had something to eat there, and now I can put you to sleep before that drive home. So we're going to talk about charge controllers and what we currently offer and get down the weeds on some of them. And like the last one, you all know me, Ryan Stankus with Midnight. Feel free to stop me anytime through here, ask questions, make jokes, whatever. So hopefully most of you are familiar. Oh, wait, my screen is probably not changing, is it? How's that? I bet you can see it now. Everybody see it? Okay, perfect. So most of you are probably familiar with the classic, but I'll go down the weeds on it anyways. It's one of the industry's most powerful charge controllers. It's one of the most flexible charge controllers. Another thing that it offers you that a lot of the other ones don't, like arc fault and ground fault built in, so there's just a lot of functionality. We already talked about the Ethernet stuff, but we'll talk about that a little bit more. Some of the things that set the Classic apart from the competition. We offer it in three different voltage levels. So if you do need to run a little higher voltage, be it a long wire run or a hydro that you're trying to use or something like that, you can do that. But if you can run at a lower voltage, you can also do that and save a little money on the controller itself. We support up to a 72-volt nominal battery, allowing you to charge up to 100 volts. We include ground fault protection and arc fault protection on every Classic built, except for the SL, but we'll talk about that in a little bit. All Classics will do solar, wind, or hydro. It shouldn't be and, it should be or. They'll only do one at a time, like we talked about earlier. If you're doing a wind turbine and a solar array, you're going to need two Classics. They all have HyperVoc, which is an interesting feature for you guys up there. We'll go into detail on that a little bit. And they all have manual and auto EQ. They're all fully internet capable. You can remote the display, or you can put two displays on a Classic if you want. They all do data logging of 380 days, as well as 380 data points over the last 24 hours. They all do Modbus over Ethernet and RS-232, which for those of you that do anything in the telecom or commercial world know that everybody wants to talk to everything and pull data from it, you know, in a single data logging device. That makes it really handy. We'll talk about that. Parallel operations, ETL listed, and it is made in America. We do all of our own in-house work. We populate our circuit boards in-house. We assemble everything. We have pick-and-place machines. You know, it's just we try to do absolutely as much in America as we can. Obviously, components come from all over the world. I think the KID casting comes from Thailand. I mean, the Classic casting comes from Thailand. The KID casting comes from Canada. So we source parts from everywhere, but we do absolutely as much as we possibly can, you know, stateside. So as Rachel touched on earlier, we did discontinue, I'll learn to talk today, the Classic Lite. The Classic Lite, for those of you that remember, had dip switches and LEDs, and that was it. It was a little cumbersome to troubleshoot and or see what was going on. It really required you to use the local app software to do virtually anything other than just make it charge from solar. And the sales just really weren't there. I think what a lot of people did was came in and looked at the Classic Lite and realized for a few dollars more they could get the full-blown one off the display and everything. So what we did is we developed a Classic SL, and that's actually stands for Sorta Lite. We have a really interesting naming scheme here at Midnight, if you haven't noticed that already. We give things some really interesting names. The SL basically is a solar-only, low-cost version of the Classic. Because it is lower cost, what we really wanted to do was compete against like the Outback FM80. So we took out the arc fault and we took out the Ethernet to make it cost competitive with an Outback controller and give you still all the other functions. We removed a lot of the stuff out of the menus like auto EQ, wind, hydro. Those are all basically just hidden. They're still in there. So if you get into a case where you put a classic SL in and you really want to make it work on a wind turbine, or you want auto EQ, we can just set a single bit in the Modbus editor and you get all those things back. But just do remember the two key components, no arc fault and no Ethernet. It does still do Modbus over RS-232, but it does not do Ethernet. Features are relatively the same. You'll notice that we lose the arc fault, and you'll notice in the communications we lose the Ethernet, and you'll notice we lose the auto EQ. They will stack with regular classics and classic lights. Basically, any classic we've ever built can be connected to another classic using Follow Me that we'll talk about later. And firmware doesn't matter. The only caveat I give to that is the display on here has a firmware package in it because it has a processor, and the control board inside has a firmware package on it. So if you've got four classics on the wall and they're all four different ages, it's a good idea to label the covers, even if you write on the inside of the cover for Sharpie, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, because if you take an old display and put it on a new controller or a new display and put it on an old controller, the firmware is not always compatible, and you can get into, you know, just an aggravation there. But there is no need to bring the older ones up to current firmware to have them talk to each other. That's only if there's features in the new firmware that you really want.
Ryan, I have a question.
Sure.
Just told us that maybe you got the four on the wall.
Yep.
And let's say that you got the one that has internet and has got everything, and the other one would be the SL. Could they be connected together?
So at this time, no. But that being said, what we do have is, because we're coming out with all these new products, we have an extremely low-cost communications box that's probably going to be $120, and it will, that's American dollars, but $120 American, and that will connect any Midnight product to it, and then it has a single Ethernet connection. So then you could get all SLs or anything else, plug it into this communications box, and now you have a web server, you have data logging, you have My Midnight, you have an Ethernet connection, a web page, just everything all in one spot.
Okay. Thank you.
Solar, wind, or hydro, and virtually anything else. So one unique thing we did, and I believe the only other one that tracks like this is Morningstar, but we realized that when we did the Outback, one of the complaints we always got in tech support was, I've got a small AGM battery, and every time your controller sweeps, my battery voltage overshoots. And we realized that we were way too slow. Basically, everybody watches things way too close. So when we did the Classic, we decided to make it extremely fast. It's basically going around the processor 100 times a second and looking at what's going on. So it's able to adjust 100 times every second what it's doing. And that allows us to track virtually anything, solar, wind, hydro, DC generation. Virtually any DC source you can find, we can probably track it and charge your battery with it with one of the settings we have in there. Roy Butler, my tech support manager, cringes every time I say that, but just give us a call. We can help you get those set up to do just about anything. It's just amazing. It's kind of neat, and with that same, down that same line, one of the things you'll run into is on some controllers, if you turn the battery breaker off, the controller will way overshoot on its battery voltage, sometimes to the point of damaging itself. You can take like the Classic of the Morningstar, and they regulate so fast that you won't even be able to see the voltage. Just be just a little flick in the voltage for about 1/100 of a second while they catch themselves. So that's something we felt really important, that was really important. And with that, it allowed us to track, like I said, virtually any DC source you can come up with. I had a guy that has 100 pedal bikes, you know, exercise bikes with generators on them. And he's got them all run through diodes and into a classic charging a battery bank that's grid-tied, some kind of exercise thing that he did. I really should get pictures of it, but it's pretty cool. So. And as we talked about with Ethernet, RS-232 and Modbus, what that allows you to do is things like this. Allows you as a programmer, or maybe not even a programmer, but somebody that can pull data from different things, to put together things like this simple web page, or you could have a PLC on site that collects data from the classics and maybe some environmental data for the site and some other things and reports it back to you. But it's just a real easy way to communicate with devices, and it's an openly published protocol. We also learned that mistake when we were doing the Outback controllers. We made that a proprietary protocol, and nobody can talk to it now. And we decided we didn't want to make that mistake again. So all of our protocols are openly published. Anybody can talk to them anytime. We're glad to help with that. Down that same road, for those of you that ever play FSMA products, we do build a communications adapter that turns our charge controller into an SMA charge controller. So SMA in Germany has a charge controller for their system, but in North America they do not. So they asked us to build this device, gave us a protocol, and we did. This basically allows Sunny Island to just command the classic of what to do, and all the classic data shows up on the Sunny Island in the web box and whatnot. And DC ground fault and arc fault. You guys may not be getting pushed on the arc fault a lot there yet, if you're not getting pushed on rapid shutdown, but it is coming. Your local code will be forcing you to do arc fault on every PV install over like 80 volts, I believe. So just know that all the regular classics have that built in, and every classic built, even the SL, have ground fault. So those both save you a bunch of time and money because they're built right in the controller, no extra breakers, components, etc. It's just done. So it's a real nice feature. And do remember again, I really like to point out, no arc fault in the classic SL. Just don't get caught on that one. So equalizing. When we started doing the equalizing in the classic, we had a bunch of installers complaining on the wrenches list, actually. Not about us, but just complaining about equalize. They got into a big heated debate about how do you properly do automatic equalization. And several of them were saying that you have to just keep trying every day until you get there. And others are saying no, because then you're holding the battery at a falsely elevated voltage multiple days in a row. So we did something different in our auto equalization. Everything else about it is the same as any of our competitors, but we gave you a function called skip days. Retry days. Skip days is something we'll talk about in a little bit. And the retry days is basically how many days it will try before it gives up. So if you set it to do a auto equalize every 30 days, and then you set retry to, say, 5 days, what will happen is on day 30, it will start an EQ charge. If it cannot accomplish it on the first day, it'll retry the second. If it doesn't accomplish, it'll retry the third. And then on the fifth day, it will give up and say, I'm going to wait for another 30 days. So we've made it just as adjustable as we possibly could for you to tailor it to what you feel is prudent. If you've got an off-grid cabin up there, it's probably only used 6 months out of the year, and the other 6 months you don't want the batteries boiling all the water out because you're not there to fill them. So you may back that way down, but in the summertime you could back that number way back up. Along that same lines, we don't talk about it in the slideshow, but we have what's called skip days. And because I made a mistake and said it, we'll talk about it. Skip days allows us to ignore the absorb and bulk charge for a certain amount of days. This is something that came to us from SMA and Rolls-Surette. Both of those companies worked together to prove that lead-acid batteries don't necessarily need to be fully charged every day if they're not being used heavily. So if you've got that cabin in the woods and you're going to walk away from it all week, you might want to set skip days for 4 or 5 days so it only does a bulk charge once every 4 or 5 days and then a float charge in between that. And that way you're not excessively using water on those batteries, but you still get that absorb charge once every week or 2 weeks to really, you know, shock that battery and knock anything off the plates. So that's kind of another neat feature, especially for remote, unattended, you know, unused systems that are going to go dormant for the winter. You can set those skip days to a longer period and not, you know, boil all the water off the battery. LED modes. Classic has a lot of LEDs. Up here, I think you can all see my mouse, but up here in the top of the vent, there's three LEDs on the control board, and then there's three right here in this smoked cover. And basically, they're going to give you status indicators or errors or current limit, etc. You can physically turn them all off in software, so they'll never come on, period. You can put them in what we call RIC mode, where they will only come on if there's a bad error. You can put them in LED 1 mode, which will give you visual indicators of like going to float, auxiliary 1 or auxiliary 2 being active, or the follow me blip, which I think we'll talk about in a little bit. Just things like that. LED 1 is where it ships, and it's probably the most useful because at a glance, you can look over and say, oh, my vent fan's on, or oh, my diversion is running, or oh, my, you know, follow me is working. It just gives you a quick at a glance look. Blinking mode really isn't useful for anything other than making it that all the LEDs blink in a random pattern. Robin wanted that in there for one of the first shows we took the Classic to, and it's never, it just got left in there. A lot of people found it kind of cool, especially, you know, at shows, or if you've got a big system, you can put them all in blinky mode, and there's all these lights flashing, you know, so, like I said, it's more for just parties or conversation than it is useful. So, upgradable firmware. This is an interesting one. Up until about 6 months ago, we've had a firmware updater for the Classic that was an install package you had to run on Windows. There was, oh, I don't know, 30-some-odd pages to the owner's the instruction manual on how to use that firmware updater. It did work good. It was just a little bit of a challenge to get there the first time out. The new updater we have now is not even an install package. It's an executable that just runs and there's no real setup to it. It finds a Classic automatically, instructs you on the screen what to do, and then sends the file to it when you tell it to. So the firmware update has got a whole lot easier on the Classic. And as it says here, we always will have free upgradable firmware. One of the neat features about that is anytime somebody comes up with something that seems like a worthy thing to put in firmware, we can have the engineering team work on that, and we can get that out to you. Or if somebody finds a bug, I kind of joke because some of our competitors will talk about how their product is bug-free, and I would ask how many in the room have an Android or an iPhone, and how many of you think it's 100% bug-free. Any manufacturer that makes power electronics and writes software will never be 100% bug-free. That's just hands down. So anytime somebody finds something, that gives us an easy way to solve that rather than having to swap the unit out or doing RMA or whatever the case may be. The update is done off a basic USB cable. Because the Classic is basically a mature product now, that cable is no longer included. The first 5 years of its life, when there were firmware updates coming out pretty regular, we did ship every Classic with that cable. So now if you get a new Classic and we do release a feature and you want it, you do just need to pick up a USB cable. It's mini B on one end and regular USB on the other. One of the new firmware updates that's coming out that Robin is hugely excited about, and I'm not 100% sure what I think yet, but Robin has always wanted the Classic to talk. He's always wanted it to talk, and that's about a couple months out now from beta testing on talking Classics. So if any of you have ever wanted a charge controller that will talk to you, have no fear, it's going to be here soon. The good news is you can disable that feature really easily. We talked about the local app software. We didn't go into a lot of detail about its data logging. I did tell you that it does data logging on the computer every 2 seconds when it's running. But the other thing the local app allows you to do is export data from the controller. So let's say you do have a customer's site or a remote telecom site. You can go out there once a year, plug into that Classic, export all the offline data, we call it, to an Excel spreadsheet to take it back and save it or analyze it, whatever you may want to do. But that is all available to you as well. All of that data that's in the Classic can be pulled through the local app. Another thing you can do with the local app is you can export and import all of the registers. So if you do have to do a warranty replacement on one, you can use the local app to pull all the registers. You install the new one, push all the registers to it, and you're done. There's no setup to it. You don't have to do all the programming. Those are a couple more things you can do. The local app also does graphing, so you can look at the graphing right on the local app and see what's going on. Just a pretty useful tool all around. And again, no cost to that. It's available to download on our website. And we pretty much beat this up earlier, but just to reiterate, anything you can do from the main screen of the Classic, you can do from the local app. And the slide says it works on Mac, so it must work on Mac. I'll have to verify that, though. And whoever it was that asked that question, definitely feel free to email me, and I will have engineering answer me on that. And if there's a problem, they can explain to us how to make it work. But just a good all-around way to program a Classic if you don't like pushing the buttons on the front of it. And I think we beat up the internet monitoring pretty well, too. Again, just a free cloud-based solution. This will be migrating to a little bit different look and a little bit different layout as we release that Combox I talked about, because this will now have to support all products. This will also have, as we get the Combox done, there'll be a way to tunnel back to your products. Anybody that's used the Outback equipment and played with the Mate 3 and the Optics RE, we'll know what I'm talking about. But you, right from the cloud, Outback's cloud, you can go in and make changes to your equipment. And you'll be able to do the same with the new My Midnight once we release that Combox. So with that remote site, instead of having to drive there and make a couple changes, you'll be able to log in here and do that as well. And go ahead.
About the link to by Wi-Fi or by wire?
So the Classic itself is a wired connection. So you would connect it to your network somehow with a wire. Now, a lot of people are doing a Wi-Fi bridge that they put right at the Classic, and it connects to the wireless internet. But the Classic itself is wired. The new Combox will be wired or wireless. It'll have an antenna hanging out of it. You can hook it on the wall beside your equipment and connect it to the wireless network at site. But the Classic itself is a hardwired connection.
Another question for you. As far as the firmware upgrade, can we do it? Do you have to be on site to do that, or can you do it through the internet?
You do have to be on site. We are working towards being able to push firmware once we do the Combox. The real problem is the risk involved with not being there, where with the Combox, it will be able to store a good image and the new image and an original image. So if something goes wrong, it'll wait like 15 minutes and revert back to the good image or whatever the case may be. So that is something we're working on the Combox. We will be able to push updates from the Combox. On the charge controller, of course, it would stop charging when it pushes that update, but should start as soon as it's done. On the inverter, on the other hand, power system, because we have redundant modules, we're going to be able to push updates to one module at a time and keep the inverter online at a little bit reduced capacity. So you'll be able to do a hard push to the inverter system where you push everything at once with the inverter shut down, or you'll be able to do a soft push where you push one module at a time. So if you were on site and just wanted to get in and out, you could do a hard push and update everything. If you were doing it remote, you could do a soft push and do one module at a time so the customer would never even know you did it. So those are some of the things that we're dealing with at the moment.
Yeah, I have a question.
Yep.
I looked at on the side of the difference for the application between the low and high frequencies. And as well, if I can use, for example, an inverter, high frequency with a charge controller, low frequency. don't really understand the difference between low and high frequency. And can I use a low frequency inverter with a high frequency charger?
Yeah, so you shouldn't really have any issues there because the two don't really have to mesh with each other than at the battery terminals. Most all charge controllers are going to be high frequency just by nature. There's just really not any issues to worry about there as far as the intermingling of a charge controller versus inverter.
Can I use the low frequency with the big machine that high power at the same time? Like, I don't know, like a wash machine or something.
I think I understand the question is if you're using furniture like a fridge or a washing machine, it will affect the performance if it's a low or high.
Actually, my finding is we'll use wash machines for an example because a lot of them now are DC inside. They're variable speed DC motors, and they're just kind of jittering back and forth when they're doing laundry. And with the standard low-frequency inverter, you'll hear that in the inverter. If you're near your inverter, you'll hear the inverter going, yer, 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 every time the washing machine spins. And as we move towards high-frequency inverters, I think you're going to see a lot of that go away because the frequency is so high, the response is much faster. I don't think you're going to see any issues there. High-frequency is not new to the battery-based inverter world. It's just never been done a lot because low-frequency has always been cheaper, I think is the best way to say it. It's got its limitations, so we have decided to try to pull all the best of the best and do high frequency and give you something as an option.
Thank you.
All right, so data logging, we touched briefly on this, but the Classic stores 380 days of daily totals, in other words, kilowatt hours for the day, high battery voltage, time and float, all the good stuff you're going to need to know to go back and troubleshoot a system or look it over and make sure it's running as designed, that kind of stuff. The other thing it does, which is kind of neat, I've got a fun story behind this. I've always been a wind nut. I had a home-built wind turbine on a 90-foot tower in the front yard. And my wife came to me one day and said, "Are there supposed to be smoke and fire coming out of the wind turbine?" And it was a really high wind event. It burnt itself up, basically, and was literally on fire on top of the pole. And it was about a 1 kilowatt wind turbine. So as soon as things settled down, I went out and looked at the controller, and I was able to go back through these 5-minute data points and find out that the thing was doing 4,200 watts when it caught on fire. So these are kind of cool. They're kind of a nice troubleshooting thing for you, but also a nice tool in your toolbox. If something's acting a little funny, you can go back and actually look at its timestamps for the last 24 hours. It takes one every 5 minutes, and it's just a stamp in time saved in memory, and you can look at that and see what was the Classic doing an hour ago or an hour and 5 minutes ago. And it's just a way to really get your head around stuff, especially when you get into wind and hydro. Solar tends to be pretty boring and usually just works really well. Wind and hydro tends to get exciting. So, the Classic's display is a graphical display. Robin really loves it, but I can tell you, based on the size, that it's really hard to get a useful representation out of that graph of what's actually happening, but it does do it. So if you do want to look at graphs on the Classic, you can, but you're going to be much happier pulling them off onto the local app and looking at them there. Auxiliaries, those of you that are familiar with it, we have two. Auxiliary 1 can be configured as a 12-volt signal or a dry contact. So if you've got to run a 12-volt vent fan, you can set it up for a 12-volt signal. It'll run the Zephyr vent fan right out of there. If you needed to run a 48-volt vent fan, you could set it up as a dry contact and run your 48 volts through Auxiliary 1 and control that vent fan. The 12-volt signal is good for 200 milliamps on auxiliary 1 and another 200 on auxiliary 2. And if you look really close and ignore the annoying blinking red LED, arrow, right underneath this silver thing, this is Classic 150, which is your Ethernet jack, by the way, you'll see two little black jumpers. And to change it from 12 volts to dry contact, you just move those jumpers left to right one pin. So it's pretty simple to do. A whole variety of different things you can do with auxiliary 1, from vent fans to what we call waste not mode, where it will divert any available electricity not needed for the battery. We can do things based on state of charge, based on PV voltage, daylight mode, night light mode, etc. Just a whole lot of interesting things there. Auxiliary 2 is predominantly a PWM signal, meaning that it switches really rapidly and it's good for like resistive heating, like electric water and heater or something. The difference being, like, if you're doing a diversion load or an opportunity load on a PV system, if you use something that's just on and off, the battery voltage is going to come up, it's going to turn that load on, the voltage is going to sag, it's going to wait through your hold time, and then it's going to turn the load off, the battery voltage is going to jump back up. When you PWM it, you actually vary the ampacity of that load. So you may have a water heater element that draws 50 amps at 48 volts. On auxiliary 1, it's either going to draw 50 amps or 0 amps. On auxiliary 2, we can make it draw anywhere from 0 amps to 50 amps. So we can vary that current that goes to that load and only give it what's left above and beyond what the batteries need. So it's much more elegant, but it does require solid-state relays, and it does require that it's a purely resistive load. Auxiliary 2 can also be set up as an input. It works with the WhizBang Junior, which we'll talk about a little later. And it will also do an interface, what we should call logic in, for like a BMS, for lithium batteries, for instance. A lot of lithium batteries have a single contactor, and if something starts to go wrong with them on a thermal issue, they will open that contactor to keep themselves from overheating or overcharging, and that shuts off everything. So predominantly speaking, if something's going to cause a lithium battery to overcharge or overheat, it's going to be the charging source, not necessarily the load. So with that logic in, they can actually send us a signal, either a ground signal or a high voltage signal, and stop us from charging. And it gives them an opportunity to try to balance things out without shutting off the inverter and the load. So it's just another tool. The BMS guys can interface. It doesn't take anything fancy. Like I said, the logic low, if you bring the auxiliary to the battery negative potential, it stops charging. The auxiliary high, if you bring it up above like 10 volts, it stops charging. So most BMSs have the ability to do that pretty easily and just offers a real elegant, low-cost interface to the BMS. And we'll jump right into the WhizBang Junior. Again, with that naming convention we have here at midnight, you'll notice that we never miss an opportunity to have some interesting names. The WhizBang Junior is basically a current sense module. It's designed to go on the standard 50 millivolt 500 amp Deltec shunt. It wires up with a single wire, that purple wire right there, into the Classic or the Kid, and it reports back the current going in and out of the battery. And with that, we get to do things like true end amps. We get to do global current limit. So one thing that I'm seeing a lot of now with PV prices coming down compared to the last few years is grid tie systems of battery backup that are horribly overdriven PV-wise. And if the grid goes down, the ability for the PV to drive the battery so hard they can damage them is there. With global current limit, of course, we can back the current limit down into the battery, but not sacrifice that current when we're trying to sell to the grid. That's just another little feature. But predominantly the most important feature this gives you is a full-blown state-of-charge battery meter. It's going to show you right on the display of the controller the actual percentage of the state of charge, and that is actually temperature compensated for capacity. It knows when the controller goes into float. It recalibrates every time the controller goes into float. So that's always going to be a very accurate number, provided you get the efficiency and the amp hour capacity programmed in correctly in the beginning. But it's going to give you a really accurate state of charge because the controller knows exactly what the batteries are doing. Unlike a standalone battery meter, that has to operate just on voltage, this one will know when it goes to float and the temperature of the batteries and everything. Another question. Oh, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I got a question for the classic.
Sure.
I just spoke with someone and he was wondering why the terminal board is so small. It's maybe a comment or more, not a question, but they have a hard time with such a small terminal board.
Yeah, and that's a very common comment that we in the customer service side of Midnight hear. And the long and short answer of that is that when the Classic was designed, when Robin first designed it, he was trying to build a 60-amp charge controller to compete against the FM60. And once they got it done, they realized how much power it could make, and it all of a sudden became a 100-amp charge controller. But unfortunately, they didn't have room on the board to put bigger lugs. So because it would hold number 4, Robin considered that acceptable. But that has always been a bit of a hassle, because you are right. If the number 4 THHN is brand new, it'll slide right in. And if you have an old Classic, you'll notice the newer ones, I engineered a modification of the terminal block that allows the cover not to be there in the beginning, so you can actually see the box lug. And that helped quite a lot, being able to see it instead of sticking it up inside that plastic thing and trying to find the hole in the lug. But that is definitely an issue. And moving forward, we are definitely beating the living daylights out of Robin. We just had this discussion on the new 200-amp charge controller, because 200 amps is a lot of current. And the first lug was 2-watt, and then the next jump is all the way up to like 350 KC mil. So a bunch of us insisted that we go with the bigger lug, because 2-watt, really isn't quite big enough for 200 amps in all situations. So it comes back to that discussion I had earlier with the DR inverter and being able to only get a couple fingers in the wiring compartment. Robin has always tended to box us into the smallest space he can find, and I think the biggest reason he does that is to try to keep costs down. But in this case, it was just basically the way the product was designed. The intent was never to be as powerful as it is, and we got caught, you know, by surprise, and at that time was all tooled up on castings and everything, and just didn't have room to go to a bigger block, unfortunately.
Thank you.
Something else on the Classic that makes you guys' job just a little bit tougher, we were able to get what we call bonus amps. One of the things that we realized early on in our career, way back in the, you know, Outback and Trace days, was that a controller will make a lot more power on a 12-volt battery than it will on a 48-volt battery. Of course, you're getting a lot more wattage through it on a 48-volt, but amperage into the battery, the controller would run a lot harder on a lower voltage battery. So when we did the Classic, we decided that we could actually get a sliding amperage current based on battery voltage. And what you're seeing here is a representation of that. You'll see that it does 96 amps on a 12-volt battery, but when it's set up for 48 volts, it'll only do 86 amps. And that's just based on a little bit of heat buildup inside. And this is not an efficiency curve. I hear this a lot, like, wow, it's really inefficient. And it's like, no, this isn't an inefficiency curve. This is just simply what it can handle continuous 24/7 without current limiting due to heat. And you will not damage a Classic from overdriving it. It'll just current limit. If it gets hot, it'll current limit back itself down. So there's no concerns there. This is just a general system design guideline telling you, okay, if I'm going to do a 24-volt battery and I'm going to have a 110-volt PV array, it can do 84 amps 24/7 without current limiting at all. If I did, you know, if I tried to do 120 volts, through the Classic and try to push it to 94 amps, eventually it's going to warm up and back the current down and stabilize it around 82 amps. And a lot of people look at that and say, well, that's a 12-amp difference. So you're saying we lose 12 amps if we run at 120 volts versus 90 volts. And no, that's not the case. The analogy I like to make, if anybody in the room has had the old incandescent nightlights, they ran at like 4 watts, And if you grabbed a hold of that bulb, it hurt. It was hot. If you put that bulb inside an aluminum box and turn it on, that box is going to get hot. So basically, the difference you're seeing here is not the efficiency of the Classic. It's how much heat the components are making inside, causing the box to get hot, and therefore we have to back the current down just so that we don't damage anything. So these are just general system design guides. They're not, you know, like I said, they're not cast in stone. The top line is the current limit. That's what it's going to be set at. The max it's going to be set at. And typically in a solar environment, you know, it ramps up through the day and it ramps down in the evening. And especially in an off-grid environment, we usually design a system such that it'll carry through most of the bad days. So the good days are just gravy. And you're going to be in float and the current's going to be regulated anyways. Which brings me to my next topic, which is the Classic can be overdriven, grossly overdriven if you want. So if you've got an off-grid house and you really want to design around those bad days up there where it's snowing and, you know, you've got clouds, you could take and put the ability, you know, you could take this Classic right here at 2,700 watts on a 24-volt battery. You could put 5,000 watts on that. The Classic is only going to produce 94 amps into the battery on a good sunny day, so it's going to current limit and throw away 94 amps. But on a cloudy day, it's going to make a bunch more power. If you're doing a battery-based grid tie, of course, that wouldn't make a lot of sense because on the good days, you're throwing away a lot of energy. But in a typical off-grid system, you're going to design around the cloudier days. And on those sunny days, you're not going to need all that power anyway. So it is okay to overdrive any of our charge controllers. The 200-volt Classic power curve, exactly the same ideas, just different currents. The one thing I do want to point out, I don't want to go over all the curve with you and bore you on that, but I do want to point out that the Classic numbers, we get a lot of misconception on that. So go, you got a Classic 150, and its MSRP is $850. You've got a Classic 250, and its MSRP is $1,050. So it's cost more money, and it's a higher number. It must be a better controller. And you'll notice that, again, these current numbers go down as we go up in voltage. And, again, simply that's just because of the heat in the components. You take a 4,500-watt array, and a half a percent in efficiency is a lot of power, and that creates heat. So the 250 may be a half a percent less efficient than the 150, which current into the battery really doesn't amount to anything, but heat in the components adds up quick. So that's basically the reason you'll see these lower numbers. And as we go to the 250, you'll notice the numbers get even lower. So that's just something to keep in mind. The other thing that I like to point out is, I wish we hadn't have done this, but they made the Classic 250 work on a 12-volt battery. In my opinion, if you're doing a 12-volt battery, you don't really want that high of a PV voltage. Go ahead and go for 150 or 200 and keep your PV voltage down, because anytime you spread those two voltages apart, when your PV voltage and your battery voltage, the farther you spread them apart, the more heat you're going to make in a charge controller. And that's true for anybody's charge controller, not just ours. The bigger that delta is, the more heat you're going to have in your components. So you ideally want to size it enough that the MPPT has headroom to work, but not so much that you're just creating a bunch of heat. We used to say you go one nominal voltage above. If you're doing a 12-volt battery, you try to do a 24-volt PV array. Now I like to say do around 150% of the battery voltage. That'll get you, that's your minimum. That'll get you in the ballpark, you know, and anything above that is gravy, you know, but if you go too far, again, you're creating some heat. Now, sometimes that it's okay for that. If you've got a 1,000-foot wire run and you want to save some money on copper, you can use a higher voltage controller, and that little bit of inefficiency, that little bit of heat loss is made up by the cost savings in the wire. We talked about the clipper a little bit. The big clipper for the Classic, basically, as we talked about, is designed to be either a standalone device, just a controller, wind or hydro from over voltage and over speed, or it can be connected up to our Classics. And when it's connected to the Classics will actually slow the turbine down as the battery gets full. So if you've got a wind turbine, you can watch that turbine actually slow down in speed as the current going into the batteries drops, to the point where when it goes to float and it's just a trickle charge, it may even just stop the turbine. So that's kind of a neat feature because it saves wear and tear. They're available in AC or DC models, and they're available in a 1.5 kilowatt and a 4 kilowatt model. So pretty flexible, all sorts of different ohmages. They have built-in resistors as a diversion for the turbine itself, not the battery, just to keep a load on the turbine. So, string sizing tools. Most of you probably have played with a string sizing tool from some manufacturer somewhere. The classic string sizing tool is a little unique because it has to accommodate four different models. We don't actually make the KS anymore, but we still show it on our string sizing tool. In a nutshell, what you need to know about this is you're going to put in your parameters over here. You're going to pick your number of modules in series, your number of parallel strings. You're going to submit those parameters, and it's going to populate all this. You're going to get some data about the PV array up here, which is good data, but where you really want to run with this is right down here. This is going to tell you right away whether your design was sound or whether you need to go back and look at it. And as you can see in this case, the 150 says it's always in hypervolt, and conveniently I should put the hypervolt slide ahead of this, not after it. But we'll talk about hypervolt in a little bit, and I'll explain that. But this basically means that the controller will never turn on. The voltage will always be too high for that controller. But you'll notice down here that the array size is okay. It's just the voltage is extreme. Then you'll notice when we go over to this one, it's going to run down to negative 75 degrees C, which if we get that cold, we've probably got bigger problems. And it's okay on the classic. A single classic is all that's required. Everything's good. Everything's green. Everything's good. You'll notice as we move over, though, this array starts to get excessive for these controllers. And this goes back to that being overdriven statement I made. You'll notice that 1.1 classics are required, and it's still green. And before you call, no, Marco cannot get you a 0.1 classic. You would have to get two. I have gotten that call before. It says I need 1.4 classics. Where do I get the 0.4? I'm sorry, you have to buy the whole other one. So that all being said, what this means is, in a nutshell, we're still happy with this because a PV array typically does 80% of its nameplate, unless you live in a really bright environment. And sometimes when it gets cold and the snow and reflections, we do get well over the nameplate. But as a general rule of thumb, you're going to get about 80 watts out of a 100-watt module max. And that's because the module is rated in what we call standard test conditions. And you guys can't see my air quotes that I'm making here, but when a manufacturer makes a PV module, they flash it with a bunch of light that represents 1,000 watts per meter squared, and that's how they rate it. In the real world, on the surface of the Earth, at the angles and everything that we're dealing with, we get about 800 watts per meter squared. So what that means for you is that you can go up to 1.2 classics before you're really going to even hit the current limit. And again, knowing that we can go well over, you know, 1.5 to two times more than classic can handle without any damage, there are times when you may want to overdrive that. So again, way deeper in the weeds than you probably want to be on this, but know that this is the meat and potatoes of it. This line up here will let you know roughly how many modules can we put in series on this controller. So even though you picked four over here, we're going to show you up here that if you was to put three in series on this 150, it would work great. So then you could go back down and pick three and recalculate. You can print these results, and you can also save them as a PDF. Okay, so now we'll talk about hypervolt, and I will reverse these slides after the show. Hypervolt is a non-operational safety zone. For those of you that have designed PV arrays, solar arrays, in the climate that you're in up there, similar to the climate I'm in here, just a little bit colder, we've always had to worry about what's the coldest temperature ever that we're going to see. And that's how we pick, you know, we calculate our VOC of the array based on the record cold that you're ever going to see in Montreal. Now, with hypervolt, we get to do that based on the average cold. Because as you know, like I know, we get maybe 1 or 2 days a year where we get near that record cold. Every time else, it's more of an average cold. So what happens in hypervolt is when that PV module exceeds the operating voltage of the classic, it goes into a non-operational zone. Nothing turns on. It stays safe. It doesn't blow up. And as soon as the sun comes up over here and warms the module up, just a touch, that voltage drops. The controller wakes right up and starts working. For those of you that aren't familiar with that, this effect, a PV module, its voltage will rise drastically as the temperature of the module decreases. And the same holds true on the other end of the spectrum. When you get a really hot summer day, the PV voltage drops as the panel voltage rises. So not only do you have to worry about the cold weather stuff with HyperVac, you have to worry about the hot weather stuff. So that's just some stuff to think about. But the HyperVac gives you a little bit of leeway in that design. So if you're going to do 3 60-cell modules on a classic 150, you're not going to hurt it in your environment. There may be one time a year where in the morning it says HyperVac for an extra 15 minutes, and then it wakes up and goes to work. It just gives you that little bit of cushion to not worry about damaging or destroying your controller. Follow me. I'll try to pick up the pace a little bit here. I don't want to keep you guys all night. Follow me allows the Classic to share its charging stages. Unlike what we did at the Outback company, we do not have a hub. We do not have all that. It uses a standard phone cable. And basically what it's going to do is it's just going to, one Classic is going to ask its neighbor, what are we doing now? And it's going to say, okay, I just went to float. So that one's going to say, okay, I'm going to go to float. And then it's going to tell its neighbor it's time to go to float. So it's just simply coordinating the charge stages, float, equalize, absorb, etc. It will carry ground fault errors across the network. It does not carry arc fault errors across the network because arc fault is specific to the PV array. So if you've got three different classics and three different PV arrays, and array one has an arc fault, you don't really need to shut down array two and three. You probably don't want to shut down array two and three. So arc fault is specific to the array. Ground fault is a system fault, so it does shut down all controllers. We talked about third-party software. This is a piece of software that was written by an avid Midnight fan. He was really sick of his Outback mate, so he wrote this software. It's up on our website for anybody that wants it. But it talks to their AXS port and allows you to do all your programming on your Outback in common English over here on a web page instead of having to poke through the mate. But that's just some of the things that are possible once you openly publish your protocol. And as another example of a web page using the openly published Modbus. And support. This actually should be at the end of the slideshow, and I do apologize. These are two brand new PowerPoints marketing just gave us. So you were the first one to see this, and even though I've practiced it, the slides are a little out of order. But basically, here at Midnight, we have several ways you can get a hold of us. We have the phones. We have an online portal. If you go to our website, there's a link that you can follow to click submit a trouble ticket. So if it's after hours or it's on the weekend, you can do that. You will find that most of the times, even on the weekend, if you submit a ticket, Jim Parrish or myself or maybe even Roy is going to answer you. So you're going to get a lot of, there's a lot of people always around. If not, there's always the forum. There's a lot of great guys on the forum that know our product inside and out and are always more than welcome to help and offer advice. Just be aware they are not Midnight employees, so take that advice with a grain of salt. So I'm going to move into the kid. Any questions on the Classic before I do go into the kid?
No.
Okay.
I don't know about my end, but it's the first time in my life that I see such good students. they're listening to you. It's amazing.
Well, that's good. And see, I figured because I didn't get there that everybody was going to have all these questions for me, you know. So, again, I do apologize for not being there in person, and I do so miss that. This is always a fun event for me. So, we will jump right into the kid. Oh, it's back up. There we go. And Rachel touched on this a little bit, but the kid comes in a matte black or gloss white. It comes in a marine or a standard. So what you see here on the left is the gloss white, and it is the marine version. The difference in the marine version really is the mounting bracket. you'll see it's got like this metal bracket in the knob, so you can like mount it to a bulkhead and everything. It comes with the battery temperature sensor, and it comes with some conduit. The standard kit comes with this plastic wall mount adapter, which, as Rachel did point out, anybody that has wired a kid before February of 2017 has probably sworn and hollered at us. And it used to be on the back of the kid, you had to hold the kid away from the wall, wire the terminals up, and then put it back into the wall mount adapter. The new wall mount adapter has a terminal block down under here, and is all wired up to the kit. So you run your wire up into the conduit holes in the bottom, take this cover off of the two Phillips screws, and all your wiring is right there. Really easy to get at. So if there's anybody with the old ones, and they have the old brackets, and they want new brackets, shoot me an email, no charge. I'll get the brackets out to you, so you'll have them to replace them, make it a little bit more friendly. The regular kid does not come with a BTS, and one of the biggest reasons that is just simply because we found the kid is usually targeting a lower cost, smaller system market, and a lot of times they don't go for all the features. So rather than burden the base price with that feature, we decided to make an option. The kit is a 30-amp charge controller. It has a full 30-amp load circuit. It has an auxiliary output like the Classic. It has an input for the WhizBang Junior. And it also does true two-wire generator start with feedback. So it's very, very versatile controller. I like to talk about it. You know, Mario is the kid. Real quick story on Mario. Back when we started Bendite, we were working actually in the shop that makes our sheet metal. We didn't even have a building. And we were doing stuff there. And as soon as we moved to our new building, Mario come knocking on the door one day after school. He was in high school. And he wanted a job. And I was like, well, we don't really have anything for you to do yet. And he goes, well, I don't need to get paid. He goes, I just need to be out of the house. My mother says I need a job. So he started hanging around and sweeping the floors. And it was not maybe a month that he'd been there that he was like really focusing on what Bobby was doing on the charge controllers, watching them, learning, helping them solder components on the board, helping them try to repair stuff, you know, as Bobby was designing the product. And he really just took to that. And we let him roll with that. We ended up bringing him on the payroll. We ended up paying him to go to school. He's now a full-blown double E and has two charge controllers under his belt going on a third one. So it's just kind of a really interesting story how he came from, you know, not really knowing what he was going to do to being an electronics engineer and building charge controllers. So it's a lot of fun because when somebody says, I'd like my charge controller to do that, those of us that have been doing this for a long time say, oh, I can't do that. And Mario will say, yes, I can. I can make that happen. And in 15 minutes, you get new firmware that makes that happen. So it's just been a lot of fun. We already talked about the Marine version versus the regular version. And we talked about the lighting controller, but just know that it does dusk to dawn, hourly, day and night settings. Pretty much real versatile. The only thing it doesn't really have is a time of day clock. So what I mean by that is you're not going to be able to tell it I want to shut the light off at midnight every night. You can tell it I want it to shut off 4 hours after dark, but not at midnight. A lot of people will end up putting a timer in there if they need that specific of a control. But generally speaking, you don't need that specific of a control for lighting controllers. The other thing we did, and we have taken some flack for this from a couple competitors, but we made standard buttons in a screen. They cost us maybe less than $1 in parts to put that in the controller. So going back to that story of trying to troubleshoot or even figure out if the system's working properly, if you don't have a display, you don't have any real eyes on the system of what's going on. You call the customer, you know, you're trying to figure out what's going on. They've got voltmeters out. They're trying to measure stuff. They may not even have voltmeters. So just by putting all that right in the kit as standard equipment, we've just made it easier. And, you know, it just takes a lot of that pain out of there. There's no more worrying about an optional display. And contrary to popular belief, it really wouldn't make the controller less expensive. You're talking, like I said, maybe $1 for parts. It's not enough you'd notice it on the end product. LEDs, similar to the Classic, with one difference. You have these three LEDs up at the top that will tell you when the last time the battery's actually been full. And again, knowing this product is targeting maybe a lower knowledge base end user, in other words, what I mean by that is if you're going to install three classics and a couple Radians or something in somebody's off-grid house, they're going to take the time to get educated because they just dropped a lot of money with you guys to install this equipment. If you go install one module and a small battery and a couple lights and a kid, they may just assume it's going to work because it's their hunting camp. They only go up a couple times a year. They're not really worried about it. So this just gives you a little bit more of a quick visual indication of what's happened. You know, the orange light's on down here. This is 2WL. That's letting us know that the controller hasn't been afloat in over 2 weeks. So it's just a real quick, at a glance, what the heck is going on here. The rest of them are pretty self-explanatory. It's in float. We're in a current limit situation or an over-temperature situation. We've got a fatal error. Or the blue LED down here comes on anytime the load circuit is operational. This is kind of an interesting feature. As far as I know, I think Morningstar does this on the 600-volt controller. One of the only ones that does this, though, and we have the ability to actually put two charge controllers on a single PV array. So you can put the two kids in what we call twin mode. One basically turns off its control module, if you will, and gets its drive from the primary one. The primary one will control both power centers and display everything on a single screen. So it basically becomes a 60-amp controller. So if you've done a small system and you need to expand it, instead of having to take the controller out and, you know, put a bigger one in, you can just parallel a second one on. That does come with some challenges because now you have to decombine the array wires into two different controllers, but that's pretty easy to do with most of the equipment we have. So just know that that feature is there. And a lot like the classic, but completely different, we have what's called sync mode on the kids. You can do up to 16 kids in sync mode. And what will happen when you turn the kids on, the first thing you'll see is they'll say looking for other kids. And if they find more kids, they will come up on the screen and say, you know, sync on every one. And on one of them, you'll press the save button. And that one becomes the master of all of the kids, if you will. It takes control. It then tells all the other kids what to charge to, what the battery temperature is, all the parameters, all 16 just do what the first one tells them to do, and that works pretty good. The downstream kids, if there is a fault in the communications cable, will revert back to standalone charging. So when you do set these up, you do still want to set all your parameters on the other 15 kids, such that if there is a fault in the communications, they will, you know, default back and charge to what they're supposed to. That they do auto reconnect if there is a loss of communication. So if you're in a real noisy environment or maybe a dirty connection on the cable and it's intermittent connection, within 30 seconds that connection will be back up. So it's a pretty stable system. It's pretty cool. And that again uses just a standard 4-conductor phone cable, or if you're in a real bind, you can even use 2-conductor phone cable for that. Question on that, or?
No question.
Okay, perfect. So, moving forward, power handling.
I've got a question now.
Sure, go ahead.
Yes, about the MPPT logic for when you put multiple kids in power, I wanted to know if the logic of the control of the PV side is the same for each of the all of the kids which are in
He is a little low on the audio, so somebody could repeat that maybe a little louder.
Yeah, it was too far, so
I wanted to about the control of the
can just come at the front so we can be able to
Yes, I wanted to know about the control logic on the PV side of the kit. when you have multiple kits connected in parallel, if does the controller remain the same for all the kits, or each kit has its controller digit? This is in the case where in which you have multiple strings, and you have each kit has its strings connected, one string connected to it.
Sure. So in twin mode, which if I back up here, maybe I can find it. Yeah, in twin mode, it's a single PV array. So only one kid will affect the MPPT algorithm and all that. The other one is just switching its power center. But when we go into the sync mode, each kid is actually individually dealing with its own PV array. So if you had 16 kids in sync, you would have 16 individual DC sources feeding each kid. And each one manipulates that source individually to maximize it. The only thing they're doing is coordinating, you know, the battery voltage and when to go to flow and all that good stuff. But they're manipulating each PV array individually.
Okay, this means if, for example, you have a PV array which is damaged, the other string will work perfectly with the
many kids. Yes. So for redundancy's sake, yes. If you had, say, three kids, three strings of PV, if this one string got damaged, the other two are going to keep working just perfectly. Yep. And the same with the fault. So if one of the kids fails, the other ones are going to just ignore it and keep on doing their thing. You know, so it's a nice redundant setup, especially for remote applications. All right, so power handling. Going back to that theory that we can overdrive any of our controllers without damage, these numbers are round numbers, and this one gets us in trouble sometimes because people will say, oh, well, my distributor has two 300-watt modules, but that's 600 watts. It's still going to be fine. It's just going to current limit at 30 amps. You could put 1,000 watts into this kid on a 12-volt battery. It's just only going to produce 30 amps into the battery. So these are just general guidelines of where you'd want to design to in normal conditions. But again, if you've got an off-grid system or a unique scenario, we're not going to get concerned if you overdrive it. Something else that I want to point out that I don't think is on any of the slides, if it is, we can skip it. But you'll notice there's these red covers on the kid. And if you can see that on your screen, it says fuse on the cover. One of the things that we found was on a lot of these smaller systems, the customers, especially the do-it-yourself customers mostly, not installers. Installers always use breakers and everything. But a lot of the do-it-yourself crowd was putting stuff in without breakers. And I can't tell you how many times I've asked somebody to reboot their charge controller or inverter, and you'll hear them, well, I got to get a wrench. I got to unhook the battery cable. You don't have a DC disconnect on this anywhere? No. So on the kid, because it's used in a marine and RV environment as well and installed by maybe a DIY crowd, we went ahead and built in fuses right in the front of it that are easily replaceable. Now, you still want your overcurrent protection in there just like you would on any other DC system, but that's just a little bit of a safety feature for those systems that may not get installed properly. String sizing tool for the kid, very similar to the classic, but much more simplified because there's only one kid, and the kid is 30 amps period no matter what the battery voltage is, so much, much simpler to read and follow. Something I didn't talk about on the classic, but I'll talk about it now. The kit supports a 12 through 48 volt battery system, but unlike some of our competitors, we don't give you windows. So if you pick 24 volts, you're not bound between, say, 20 volts and 30 volts. You could pick 12 volts and you could crank it all the way up to 45 volts. So if you've got a 29 volt battery or a 31 volt battery or any odd voltage, we can adjust that, no problem at all. It's just adjustable all the way from 10 volts to 64 volts on a kid, and it's adjustable from 10 volts to 100 volts on a classic. So if a lot of these new technologies coming out in the lithium world, other things, we're seeing a lot of different voltages, it just made sense to go ahead and make that infinitely adjustable for you. And when you do start the kit up, you're going to get a quick start guide. And interestingly, way off topic, and I digress, but the we have language packs coming for the kid. And I'll have to check into that. I need to check into that because I know we have French and Spanish all done. So if you have a kid charge controller, you can download a French firmware and drop in it. And everything on the screen is going to be in French instead of English, or the same with Spanish. So I need to look into that and figure out why we haven't got that up on the website yet. But that's just, I just wanted to throw that out there that we are working that way. So definitely beat up on me, and I will push that cart down the road as fast as I can. Like it says here, the kit will support virtually any battery voltage or chemistry. The absorb timer can be adjusted down to 0 minutes. So if you need to defeat absorb for like a lithium battery, we can do that. Just extremely flexible. Really trying to accommodate any chemistry that you may run into out there. HyperVoc on the kit, quite similar to the Classic, except for you're limited to 162 volts maximum on the kit. So you only get 12 volts of headroom on that kit. And that's basically due to the smaller PV capacitors inside it. And mounting the kit. We've talked about this quite a bit already, but the marine version comes with this bracket. The standard version comes with this plastic wall mount adapter. And if you're going to use it in an application like a mobile application or a power center of some form, there's actually a template in the manual that you can put on the wall and trace around. You can cut out a hole in the wall and actually bolt the kid right flush into the wall so you don't have all this stuff out on the front side, and then you'd wire it from the back side like in a marine or RV or something like that. Firmware updates. Different than the Classic. The kid still uses the USB cable, but on the kid, what you do is you go into the tech menu and you press firmware update. When you do, a little thumb drive folder pops up on your computer. Then you just simply grab the file, drag it, and drop it in the thumb drive, and it'll say updating on the screen here. It'll say updated, and then it'll start counting up in percentage. And it takes about 10 minutes to update, and the kid goes right back to work when it's done. Whizbane Jr., oh, go ahead.
My question. About the update of the firmware.
Yeah.
If we sort, we have sort the regulator outside of the Canada and very far without any internet and out of regular circuit. What happens if the client don't do the update?
Yeah, so good question. What happens if the client does not update their kit? For the most part, firmware updates are usually done for features that people want. So usually there's no problem. I can say on the kit that really there hasn't been any real bugs that have been damaging or deal breakers. They've all been little nuances. So for the most part, nothing. It's going to run just fine. The only real reason, and I stand by this, the only real reason to update firmware in any product is because it doesn't do something you want it to do. So if the manufacturer releases a new cool feature and you really, really want that feature, then by all means, update the firmware. But if the product is running great and doing everything you want it to do, I would not touch it personally. It's just a can of worms. You know, if it's doing everything you want it to do, why even open that can of worms? So in your case, as long as the customer is happy and it's doing what they need it to do, no update needed.
At the, when you send the your products to the to an MRT, the firmware is updated. Or have to check it before send to the customer.
So, I didn't get the first part of that. When what happens?
Let's say that you're sending
to the reseller.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, so the firmware, most of your, I don't want to speak for Marco, but most of the distributors do not unbox and update firmware and product as the manufacturer releases new firmware updates. So let's pick on Marco a little bit there and say that if, let's say Marco bought a lot of kids early on and kept them on the shelf, there's a chance that some of those could be older and the firmware could be a little older. But most, for the most part, I think most of the distributors do a really good job at rotating their stock and keeping things pretty fresh. And Marco may even unbox them and update them if there's a big update. We had one on the Classic where we released the Classic code and realized within a week that we really had a problem. And we tracked down every single one that was still in distribution. And we either replaced them or took care of the distributor to take the time to update them for us on their level. But for the kid, for the most part, there just really hasn't been any firmware updates that have been any deal breaker, so it really isn't an issue.
To do the firmware, we have to, the system is in service. Under the batteries and the PV are installed.
Well, it doesn't have to be in service, so you could actually use just a regular 9-volt Energizer battery to power the kid to do a firmware update. You could use a power supply, anything really. So if you as an installer or a reseller wanted to update it before you sent it out, you could just have a little like cell phone charger that you cut the end off, wire into the kid's terminals to power it up to do the firmware update. It does not need the PV running to do it.
That's perfect. Thanks.
Yep. So Whizbang Jr., I think we beat that up enough on the Classic. Basically, it does exactly the same thing it does on the Classic. It's a single wire hookup, gives you a fuel gauge on the display. And the Brat. So we're going to move on to the Brat. Rachel probably give you all the highlights on this anyways already. It's a pretty simple product. It is our only PWM charge controller. Everything else we do is MPPT. It has selectable charging modes. It does true bulk absorb float and equalize and auto-equalize. It has an 8-position switch up here, dip switches, that you can select the different solar mode or 12 or 24-volt battery, deep discharge on the battery for the low-voltage disconnect. Basically, everything you need to do is right here on this switch or this little rotary switch. The rotary switch controls all your load control settings, like dusk to dawn or on for 6 hours after dark and on 2 hours before dawn. All those different things are controlled on the rotary switch. The dip switches do all of your main hardware, like 12 or 24 volts, deep discharge. One of the differences with our controller is that if you don't need that load circuit, you can actually flip a dip switch over here, which will parallel the load circuit into the charging circuit, and this will become a 30-amp charge control instead of a 20. You do lose a load circuit to do that, though. It does support flooded gel and AGM. It does do temperature compensation for ambient. You'll see this little blue wire. There is a thermistor right there outside the case that allows it to monitor the ambient temperature and adjust, but it does not have an external BTS. Another neat feature about it is it actually looks just like you see it here. It is in a clear case, and it is outdoor rated. You can nail it right to a tree, wire up a solar panel, and power a light. It's just, you know, real cool like that. No fans, etc. It does have 4 LEDs up in here. You just barely see them in this picture. And you'll notice on the cover, there's some definitions embossed in the cover. One of the things we tried to do on the Brat was put everything you needed to know written on it. So if the owner's manual is thrown away or whatever the case may be, you really should be able to find out everything you need to know right from the sticker inside and the embossment on the outside. The only thing you're not going to get is the blinking patterns for different errors. If the battery's low and the load tries to come on, the load light blinks to let you know it's supposed to be on, but the battery's too low. Like we talked about, lighting controller, probably one of the most versatile in the industry. We took a look at our competition and what they offered, and the rotary switch we picked had about three more positions, so we made a few more options and filled it up. Clear UV stabilized case for outdoor rain and bug proof, and again, built right in Washington State, all the circuit boards populated in-house, all the good stuff. Does come with the strain release as shown. And I think that beats charge controllers right into the ground, so I'm going to say go ahead and shoot your questions away and we'll see what we can take care of.
That was pretty much complete.
Good.
No, there's no question, but okay.
We've seen the kid Mario graph, we're just trying to see the ratio.
So one thing you can do, here's an interesting thing that we do at midnight, is if you go to this tab called Gallery, and you go to Midnight Employees, here, for good, bad, or indifferent, you'll get a picture of every employee that works here. And I think Rachel's actually stepped out. I got a message from her. She had a little bit of an emergency. She had to step away. But she is in here somewhere. Let's see. There she is. So that is Rachel. That is your sales lady that you'll be talking to. She's pretty much the only one we have in sales because we all sort of wear a lot of hats. You may get Roy or I or even Jim Parrish when you call for sales. But this is just usually pretty up to date. This is Kyle. He's new in tech support. Real interesting fella, real sense of humor. So you may get him when you call. Two of our tech support employees is Roy Butler. He's been a long time off-grid guy, wind guy, just a real ball of knowledge. I mean, he's been there and done it and got the scars to prove he learned it the hard way. And we got Jim Parrish here somewhere. Jim is the other one that you'll get in tech support right here. Jim does tech support from his RV. He has a nice little RV that's all solar powered, and he actually has his office set up in it, so he goes out and sets in his RV because he lives in Florida where it's always nice and warm. So I frequently tell him he sucks, especially when it's snowing here, but you know. You know, this is just you'll find a lot of our employees here, most all of them actually. Production line workers, everything. This is obviously not all of them because we're at about 75 employees right now. But this is usually pretty current. And if you're talking to somebody on the phone, they say, hey, my name is Sue, or you're at a show and you've met Sue, there's Sue. You know, you can go find him on the website, put a face of a name.
Look, Ryan, I really want to thank you and Rachel for this webinar. For the first experience as Rheumatic Energy for a webinar, we are quite surprised about the efficiency of the webinar, and we love, me personally, I'm amazed that you've been able to turn around so fast.
Yep.
You came up to the reseller, installer, all the opportunity to have the product knowledge. So we sincerely want to thank you very much for your help and your understanding.
Yeah, and I apologize for not being there in person. It's definitely more fun in person. But anytime I can do anything, and if there's ever a specific subject that Rheumatech wants to offer training on, I'm happy to do these webinars anytime. So, you know, anybody feel free to reach out to me anytime. We'll take care of you. And I promise I'll be there next year, even if I got to put chains on the truck and drive up. So.
But we understand that we had a very bad temperature here too. Not 5 feet like you guys, but it was quite amazing to just drive through here. It was really tough. So it's a good time to learn. There's no installation that have been made today and yesterday. So it's
This was looking out my front door, noontime Monday. So, and it was still snowing. It was up to the top of the window by the time it quit snowing Monday. So it was pretty cool. So.
Nice day to go to the beach.
Yeah, it was a nice day to sit beside the wood stove and think I'm not going anywhere. Yeah. So just a few shots, a little bit of snow when it first started. So.
Okay.
All right, guys. Well, I really appreciate it. I appreciate you being flexible and working with me, and hope this was helpful for everybody. And I'm here anytime you need me.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good afternoon.